receive.
I talked to Art McNally about that last night, about Fred Silva being the alternate official. He said, despite the controversial calls, he is still rates very high in our opinion. I think it's a nice gesture on their part.
Right you are, Alex, as we look at a close-up of Tony Dorsett 1 year ago in a bowl game, leading Pittsburgh to victory, and he ran for over 200 yards that day. And now, of course, in the big leagues, in the NFC Championship game, it'll be Tony Dorsett and the Cowboys as we look now at the two men to receive. Manfred Moore, number 36, will be deep. Sammy White will be up short to his right, and to his left, Robert Miller. Three men in the middle of the block, Keller, along with Hamilton and Yeri. And we're waiting for Efren Herrera, the pride of Guadalajara. Efren, who has been the NFC All-Pro kicker, he led the conference with 93 points. And Herrera will kick it off. And in one moment, the NFC Championship game gets underway to find out who plays Denver in the Super Bowl. Belts it deep. That means Manfred Moore on his 7-yard line. To the 20, to the 25, to the 30, to the 35, at the 38. Mike Hegman brought him down, making first contact. Right there with him was Bruce Huther. So we'll take a look at the Vikings offensively. Up front, Riley, Goodrum, Tinglehoff, White, and Yeri. The men who'll handle the football. Ahmad Rashad, Sammy White, and the tight end, Stu Boyd. In the backfield, Bob Lee at the helm, Robert Miller and Chuck Foreman, the running backs.
First series will be critical for the Vikings. They can get 7 points on the board. Their chances are greatly enhanced, I'll tell you that.
First and 10 from the Viking 38-yard line. And it's Chuck Foreman with Bob Miller leading a pack, and he gets it to the 40-yard line. A pickup of 2, so it'll be 2nd and 8. Let's take a look at the Pokes now, the Cowboys defensively, with Jones, Pugh, White, and Martin. And by the way, number 75, Jethro Pugh, in his 21st playoff game. Henderson, Brunig, and Lewis, and the linebackers, Barnes, Kyle, and at safeties, Waters and Harris. On the sidelines, keeping his arm loose and ready, Roger Staubach. 2nd and 8 from the 40-yard line, White wide left, Rashad right, play action fake to Miller. Down the left side, broken up by Aaron Kyle. The pass was intended for Sammy White.
That time the Dallas was in that flex defense. If you remember what the 49ers did to him, they scored about 35 points on Dallas in just that way. Flex defense is very effective against the run, but not so effective against the pass because you touch down your pass rush.
53-year-old Tom Landry, the only coach that Dallas ever had. And his overall record, 161 victories. There is Doug Dumbler, who did a remarkable job of snapping the ball in the mud in Los Angeles. 3rd and 8 from the 40-yard line. Slot left. White is inside Grimm. Foreman to Miller, who fumbled, and I think Dallas has recovered. Let's see.
Harvey Martin fell on it. Harvey Martin.
Robert Miller on what appeared to be an unsure handoff. Take another look.
Let's take a look at it and see where the ball comes loose. The handoff is made there. He just lost his poor exchange some way or another. I don't believe he ever had possession. There's Martin 79 coming down on it. A big break, obviously, for Dallas.
It looked like it went just under the left arm of Robert Miller, and he didn't have control of it at all. So it is 1st and 10 on the Minnesota 39-yard line, and the Cowboys in a big spot right away. Hugh Pearson is left. Jay Saldy on a wing. Newhouse and Dorsett behind Staubach. Robert Newhouse. And he is hit by McNeil, and he carries McNeil to the 32-yard line. Dallas offensively, Neely, who is going to retire after this year, Scott Fitzgerald, Rafferty, and Donovan. Golden Richards, Drew Pearson, and the tight end, Billy Joe Dupre. In the backfield, Roger Staubach, along with Tony Dorsett and Robert Newhouse. 2nd and 3. Motion is Drew Pearson. One fake by Staubach. And deep down the left side is Golden Richards. Touchdown Dallas.
All of a sudden. What about it, Ben?
We Richardson down in the bag. Faked a little quick screen that time. Golden Richards just took off. They overcommitted. Take a look at Golden Richards. Number 83. Look at him. He just lags there. Watches Bobby Bryant come up, try to force that quick screen. Gets behind him. Like a stand-up two-bagger, Ben.
A disastrous turn of event for Minnesota. And a big play for Roger Staubach and the Cowboys. A 32-yard scoring pass. Golden Richards all alone. Bobby Bryant, nothing to do but watch him fall in the end zone. Herrera trying to make it 7-0. No good. And so Efren Herrera shocks this crowd by failing the point after. He was 39 for 41 in the regular season, but he missed that one. And so in the early going, Dallas has drawn first blood, leading 6-0. In less than 2 minutes, Dallas leading Minnesota 6-0. Harvey Martin recovering a fumble by Robert Miller, and Staubach cashing in chips with two plays, a 32-yard touchdown pass to Golden Richards for 6. Efren Herrera missing the point after. We have 13:22 to go in the first quarter. The chairs aren't warm yet, if they heat up at all here in Texas today. And it's Manfred Moore to the 15, to the 20, to the 25, 30, 35, 40, 42. Herrera tried to bring him down and couldn't. Randy Hughes finally hit him at the 42-yard line. A big return by Manfred Moore.
Manfred Moore came over in a trade from San Francisco. Last week he was outstanding on punt returns for the Vikings. That's something you don't see happen to the Cowboys very often. Mike Ditka and his special teams doing a heck of a job this year. Look at Efren there. He's a pretty good athlete. He has made a lot of tackles on kickoff teams, unlike so many of the other kickers around.
The first tackle Herrera ever made on a kickoff for Dallas, he knocked the receiver unconscious. First and 10. Foreman barreling across the 45, out to the 47-yard line. And, of course, for Minnesota, they need to do something to pump up the spirits.
Chuck Foreman is not a bad way to start. What a week he had last week. Over 100 yards in that mud out in Los Angeles. Played a great inspirational game last week.
Chuck Foreman and Robert Miller, there's Too Tall Jones. Too tall at 6'9", 265. His mother is 5'5 and a half, which is a shocker. Second and 6 from the 47. Second man, Robert Miller. And his Jethro Pugh tried to hook him, slowed him up, and down he went. Pugh trying to bring him down with one arm, but Robert Miller, pretty tough little hombre at 5'11", 204-pounder out of Kansas, playing for the injured Brent McClanahan. Remember that Walter Payton in 13 carries could get only 60 yards against this tough Dallas defense. So the challenge is out there for the Vikings. Third and 4 from almost a long 5.
That thing 9 feet over the receivers.
So the Minnesota Vikings won the toss, and that's about all so far. Looks concerned. From here, you would have to think she might be a Minnesota
like
fan.
Barbara Streisand.
So on a 4th and 4, Neil Clabo will be punting from his own 35-yard line. Larry Brinson deep. And Butch Johnson will handle it. And
look,
Johnson
out.
Is staggered, but stays on his feet and finally goes down just short. It was Studwell who hit him first. And he finally brought it back up across the 20-yard line, as you saw. So we've got 11 minutes and 42 seconds to go in the first quarter. Dallas 6, Minnesota nothing. Benny Barnes, a 6-year man out of Stanford, injured on that last punt. And Barnes slowly coming off the field. And meanwhile, on the sidelines, it's the Dallas Cowpoke against the Minnesota Vikings.
Get after it.
Meanwhile, Roger Staubach and company will put it in play. First and 10. The ball just shy of the 20-yard line. Dallas leading 6-0, 11:42 in the first quarter. Drew Pearson is wide right. Robert Newhouse grabbed by Fred McNeil at the 20, and he falls forward to the 22 because it was a high tackle. Benny Barnes being ministered to right now. Looks like he got a kick in the inside of the right knee.
I don't believe it's serious. He'll probably be back in the ballgame. Mark Washington has been a starter on that side and was, in fact, for two or three years before Barnes moved him out of there. He can play very capably.
On that last play, Tony Dorsett getting up very slowly. Second and eight from the Cowboy 22. Pearson is wide left, Golden Richards wide right. Dorsett, deep man out of the eye. Staubach on a draw to Dorsett. He runs by Matt Blair. Jeff Seaman brings him down, and Paul Krause goes over the top of his helmet as he is just short of the first down. I would figure he'll need a yard.
Dorsett is getting up kind of slow. Look at that.
He took a lick on the previous play. I'm surprised he went into the huddle hurting from the previous play. I'm surprised they gave him the ball that time.
He got an injury last week, came back in, and two plays later scored. Guy like that. Whoa.
Of course, Roger Staubach, the quarterback, played with a bad thumb, a bad bruise. In fact, Blackie Sheridan, talking about Staubach, said he sits down as often as the Statue of Liberty.
Roger played with anything. He's quite a competitor.
So he's
very
expecting Dorsett to do the same. Pearson wide left. Butch Johnson wide right. Both backs go out, and so does Staubach. And he runs into Seaman, who brings him down just very close to the first down. It'll be a question as to where they spot it.
Pretty near, but not plumb.
Not quite. Evidently a pretty good job on the Minnesota secondary with all the receivers covered, and Roger trying to go for the first down, couldn't do it.
I think Roger might have had a run in mind that time. He didn't take a very deep drop that time, Ben.
Manfred Moore goes back to the Viking 32-yard line, and Danny White will be kicking from the Dallas 15. 9:35 in the first quarter. It is 6-0 Dallas. And it'll bounce just above the 40. It'll go out of bounds at the 41-yard line. So Minnesota, for the second time, gets pretty good field position. It'll be the third time they get their hands on the football, and the Cowboys cashed in their first set in two plays to lead 6-0.
Or cruel hoax. 60 Minutes, incognito at a health spa. Tonight only at 8:30, 7:30 Central and Mountain, 7 Pacific Time.
Minnesota will put it in play, first and 10. The ball just across the 41-yard line. Dallas leading 6-0. Robert Miller fumbled, Harvey Martin recovered. Roger Staubach, a 32-yard touchdown pass to Golden Richie. Bob Lee, play action fake. Setting up and goes down the right side over the head of Sammy White. Mark Washington in there for the injured Benny Barnes was covering the receiver.
And had him covered all the way that time, too.
Sammy White and Bob Lee. Lee is quite a story. His dad was the news editor and bureau chief for the Associated Press. He used to go into locker rooms in San Francisco and get post-game quotes. With the biggest event in his life, when he was 10 years old, he had an infection of the frontal sinus and the bone around the eyeball. He had an operation that saved his life, and 22 years later, here he is in the championship game. Second and 10 from the 42. Chuck Foreman running into a crowd and brought down shy of the 45.
Jethro Pugh and Ed Jones, too tall. Last two games have been his strongest ever in his career. He's really coming on. Let's take a look at a wheel. Let's take a look at it. Chuck Foreman, number 44, with a handoff. Look at Ed Jones there, number 72. What a grasp. Jamming it all up. Well, they drafted him number one, and they thought he was going to be the world beater. And he was kind of slow. He's been a steady performer, but in the last 2 weeks, they tell me he's come on to be one of the really top defensive players in the game.
Big play, third and eight. Rashad wide left, right in a slot inside Grimm to the right. Back staying in, now the release to Foreman, and he gets across midfield and picks up the first down. Cliff Harris met him head on as he went hurtling through the air.
Well, you wonder why he doesn't have more injuries than he does, as reckless as he plays. What a reckless, abandoned player he is. Bob Lee with a rollout, couldn't throw a safer pass than this. He needs to get a couple completions, settle him down a little bit. Watch this. The guy's legs are still running in the air.
Mark Washington upended him, and Cliff Harris hit him head on. So the Vikings have it first and 10 on the Cowboy 47. Rashad is left, right is right. Here goes Robert Miller behind a Charles Goodrum block, and he gets across the 45. Goody, number 68, was leading the pack. We mentioned veteran teams. Mick Tinglehoff and Jim Marshall for the Vikings in their 19th playoff game. Jethro Pugh, number 75 for Dallas, in his 21st playoff game. And on the sideline, Benny Barnes getting that right knee taped. Figures that Benny Barnes will be back a little bit later. Second and seven. And Foreman gets to the 40-yard line. So he still has 3 yards to go for the first down to keep the drive alive.
My boy Charlie Waters on attack. Clemson University. Come on to be one of the top safety men in football. 3 interceptions last week in that game against the Bears.
That tied a record that goes back to 1944. So Charlie Waters, number 43, along with Cliff Harris.
Charlie just had a little baby girl about a week ago, I guess. 10 pounds.
Third down and 3 from the 40. And it is Foreman. Who else? And he is across the 35 for the first down. Brought down by who else? Cliff Harris.
Mick Tinglehoff, a veteran of so many years, 16 of them, and Ed White. Watch their blocks this time. Good one by Yeri, too. Big gaping hole, as you see there. Cliff Harris finally nails it.
The Dallas bench, and in particular, Robert Newhouse, keeping his hands warm. First and 10 from the 34. Lee looking down the right side, throws it through the hands of Sammy White. Just over the fingertips of Mark Washington and out of bounds before Waters could get over.
Sammy White was shut out last week against the Rams. That's unusual for him. Heck of a receiver. Rookie of the year, as everybody knows, last year. 9 touchdown passes this year. He can hurt you deep.
The Vikings put the ball in play first and 10 on their own 42. They have now reached the Cowboy 34. Second and 10. Bud Grant, surrounded by his men. 50-year-old, is won over 107 regular games. Second and 10 from the Cowboy 34. White is inside Rashad in a slot right. Play action fake to Foreman. Lee down the right side, no good. Intended for Ahmad Rashad. Mark Washington was there, and apparently they're going after the corner.
And the coverage was there. Slips a little bit, I believe. Let's look at Rashad. Yep, slipped on that turf. It's been raining all week here in Dallas until yesterday. That field could be a little bit wet from that.
So it is third and 10 from the 34. Six to nothing, Dallas. Efren Herrera missing the point after. And now the Vikings try to keep the drive alive. They have Bob Grimm wide right with White in a slot. Rashad is wide left. Lee just over the hands of the intended receiver, Robert Miller, trying to angle it out of bounds. And he goes for the corner and gets it out. And it'll go out of bounds at the 11-yard line. That's where the Cowboys will put it in play. First and 10 from their own 11. The 23-yard punt with no return. 5:52 to go in the first quarter. 6-0 Dallas. The 1978 CBS Sports Spectacular, presenting an exciting calendar of outstanding events. In January, the WBC World Light Heavyweight Championship between defending champion Miguel Cuejo and Matei Farlaw. The World Lightweight Championship, Roberto Duran against Esteban De Jesus, also coming up. So that'll be 1978 CBS Sports Spectacular, something to see. First and 10 from the 11. Tony Dorsett gets out across the 10-yard line before jumping over people to go down shy of the 15.
Herbert Scott, number 68 on the trap block here on Eller. Let's look at it. Eller, he got a good position on him that time. Closed it down pretty good, though. Last week, those Viking linebackers played just an exceptional game. They're going to have to do the same thing today if they're going to contain this high-powered Dallas offense.
So Dallas with a second and 7, the ball on their own 14-yard line. Staubach flipping back to Newhouse. Robert Blair gets him, but he gets away, and then the rest of the Vikings close in on him. So Matt Blair had him behind the line of scrimmage, couldn't hold on to him. still was able to come back and gather him in. Tom Landry. Boy, what a story. The sixth all-time winning list. He came in with 161 overall victories during his reign. And as we mentioned, if he wins today, he'll have won 13 playoff games, breaking a tie with Don Shula. The Staubach leading 6-0 with a third and five. And they'll load up the shotgun, going to the slight spread. Staubach down the right side, intended for Dorsett. Matt Blair was right there with him. No chance.
Carl Eller put a little rush on that time, and Staubach threw it a little bit before he wanted to. Dorsett was coming wide open that time. Had plenty of field to run, too.
Danny White, who will be coming in to punt for Dallas, has averaged 39 yards a punt.
Let's watch it out of that shotgun, the way Rogers sees it. Look at Ellen. Led the team in sacks this year with about 14. Boy, he's been a steady performer through the years. And a great individual, too, Danny.
Danny White will be kicking to Manfred Moore. White from his own five-yard line. Under a rush by McNeil, but he got it away. Manfred Moore, a fair catch. Otherwise, Tom Henderson would have knocked him into Oklahoma. Henderson was right down there underneath it.
Got it on the right side of your picture there. You see the rush there. Almost got it. How he got it out of there, I don't know.
That's Fred McNeil, number 54, who just missed smothering it. This telecast presented by authority of the National Football League, intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of the Dallas Cowboys and the National Football League is prohibited. First and 10 from the Cowboy 48. Lee to Robert Miller, still on his feet across the 45. Underneath at the very bottom making the play is Tom Henderson.
Boy, the Cowgirls, they get a lot of mileage out of those cheerleaders, haven't they? Beautiful women, too.
By the way, Benny Barnes, number 31, is back in action after getting that right knee taped. Though Mark Washington, who did a good job in his stead, comes out, Barnes is back in there. Second and 7, the ball just inside the 45. Foreman is gobbled up, and what a hit, a fumble, and Big Jones had racked him. The Cowboys seem to think that they have recovered, and now it is made official. What a hit by Jones.
Took the good, strong inside rush that time. Beat Ron Yeary, I suppose. Let me take a look at it and see. Behind the quarterback, let's take a look. Look at it. Oh, brother. Yes, sir. Robert Miller had the block on him that time. It wasn't Yeary beat at all. Just a good, solid inside rush that time. Gambled and gambled right.
Then it would be the second fumble recovery by Harvey Martin, who recovered Robert Miller's fumble earlier, and now this one by Foreman. First and 10 Cowboys on their own 45. 6-0 Dallas. Robert Newhouse and McNeil straightens him up along with Seaman, and they bring him down at the 48-yard line. Remember, Minnesota had a penchant for turnovers, 18 during the regular year.
Fred McNeil, every game gets a little better, a little stronger. Well, they're a determined group. Don't count the Vikings out, Ben. If determination means anything, don't count them out.
There's a Viking and a Cowboy.
Peaceful enough right now.
Second and 7 for the Cowboys on their own 48. Golden Richards wide left, Drew Pearson in motion. Play action fake to Dorsett, and Staubach releases to Robert Newhouse. And right there waiting is Matt Blair to take him down. However, they have moved the ball into Viking territory, and they need almost 3 yards for a first down. 6'9", too tall Jones, who made that savage hit on Chuck Foreman.
Too tall, tall sitting down. I'll tell you what, when he is sitting down, he's so tall, it takes him 32 minutes to stand up, then.
He's 6'9", a lot of man, as Chuck Foreman can attest to. Bud Grant, who has seen the Viking ball club fumble and turn the ball over so often during the year, two costly fumbles so far today. Third and 2. And it'll be Dorsett. And it just depends as he runs into a gang. It did not appear from the first look that he got the first down.
The Vikings get stubborn, damn it. They gave Peyton 275 yards in their game, and they only scored, gave up 10 points. They give you a lot of yardage on the ground, but when it gets down there in nitpicking time, they get tough.
One thing about the Vikings, if they had really been discouraged, they'd never have made it this far.
Watch it again here. Newhouse, number 45. Salvi holding his block all right. The Vikings not allowing them the big play there. Let's see what they do on the fourth down.
Fourth down, Manfred Moore going deep, flanked by Bob Grimm on his right and Joe Blahack on his left, number 21. And Danny White will be punting. He's averaged 39.6 yards a punt. From his own 45, he tries to kick it out of bounds. Instead, it is snared on a fair catch by Manfred Moore on his own 11-yard line. And so the Vikings, for the first time, do not have good field position. That's the one thing they've had. That was a 35-yard punt. Say we got a great night tonight. Be sure to watch for 60 minutes at 8:30, 7:30 Central and Mountain, and it's regular time, 7 o'clock Pacific. Then be in Mel's Diner when George Burns drops in to stir things up on Alice. And wrapping up tonight's entertainment, another great Carol Burnett show. Guest star Steve Lawrence.
George Burns is too old to stir up anything, Bill.
First and 10 from the Minnesota 12. And Foreman wrapped up just as he got to the line of scrimmage. Randy White, among others, plugging it up.
Boy, he is the player that's coming on. Replacing Bob Lilly in there is a big shoes to fill, but brother, if there's a guy that can do it, he is. Gracious me. Randy White, out of Maryland. He's going to be a great football player. Not as big as Lilly, but every bit as quick, perhaps even stronger.
So they picked up one on that play. As we look at Ron Yeary trying to find out where Ed Jones is coming from. Second and 9, Sammy White in motion to the left. And Chuck Foreman gets across the 15 to the 17. Bob Brunig had a big shot and brought him down, number 53. Brunig has done a good job inheriting a great role played by Leroy Jordan.
Leroy played it for so long, so well, but it takes a while to play this Dallas defense, particularly in the middle. Brunig will get better and better. He's probably the weakest linebacker. That's not saying he's weak, though.
It'll be a second and now third and 5 from the 17-yard line. Sammy White goes left, Ahmad Rashad right, and the backs are split. We'll see if Lee passes now. Nope, it's Foreman trying to get around Jones, but that was such a big trip that he was caught from behind. And it was Brunig who got him again as he tried to go around too tall.
Yeah, Jones is playing like gangbusters. I'm telling you, he's watching, man. He strings it out this time, playing off the block of Ron Yeary. Watch this now. Just exactly the way he's controlled Yeary altogether. Just strings it out. Pursuit, they'll be ill. Brunig.
So the quarter ends, and Dallas, as they were with less than 2 into it, leading 6-0. Minnesota, as we start the second quarter, unable to move the ball. And so on a 4th and 4, Neil Clabo will have to punt it out from his own 5-yard line. Butch Johnson all alone on the Cowboy 40. And Butch comes to meet it head-on at midfield to the 45, and down he goes, Matt Blair, bringing him down immediately. So Butch Johnson, who, by the way, his real name is Michael. That ought to get some airing. And Butch Johnson brings the return back, and Dallas will take over a 4-yard return on a 32-yard punt. 6-0 Dallas. A Robert Miller fumble recovered by Harvey Martin. A 32-yard touchdown pass. Roger Staubach to Golden Richards. First and 10 from the 46 of Minnesota. Dorsett and Newhouse. Slot left. And in motion goes Newhouse. Pitch back to Dorsett. The first man to come up and slow him down was Nate Wright. He tried to jitterbug around Nate, and that took up too much time. Meanwhile, a difference of opinion down below. A problem of some kind down below. And there it is, a blanket, evidently, and inadvertently catching on fire.
The person.
And at first they told us a blanket. My goodness, it's a man.
Anything can happen in Texas. Woo!
I pray he's off. That's Drew Pearson in motion to the left. Staubach giving to Dorsett. He has Donovan putting a block on Nate Wright, but he couldn't do it. And Rafferty finally pushing Nate around a little, and Nate still able to slow him down and jam it up. Number 43 from Minnesota, Nate Wright, ruining that play for the Dallas Cowboys. Ball on the Minnesota 44-yard line. The Cowboys got an early score, and they're holding it.
The Vikings should be a tired team. That's what Bud Grant indicated at the press conference. They've had four different practice fields in the last 4 days. In the last seven games in the season, they've been in six different seasons. They're a weary team. They're going to give you a performance.
Out of the shotgun goes Staubach, third and seven. Roger cranking up and going down the right side off the hand of Nate Wright, and it was intended for Drew Pearson.
The same area they slipped a little while ago. It might be some wet turf down there somehow.
So Drew Pearson going off, as are the offensive line and the Cowboys, and the special teams come in for Minnesota. Now Manfred Moore and Bob Grimm go back along with Joe Blaha. And Danny White will be punting for the Cowboys. Just the start of the second quarter, with Dallas leading Minnesota 6-0. Mark Washington and Aaron Kyle are the two men to get down.
Look out.
Danny White is running to the 35, 30, out of bounds, and it is first down Dallas. As Danny White runs for the first down out of punt formation.
That's something you don't expect to have happen in a championship game to the Minnesota Vikings at all.
It is the first time it has happened this year.
And that's preconceived. They knew what they were doing that time. You see the convoy waiting for him. Danny White, backup quarterback to Roger Staubach, a punter, but he's an all-around athlete, a good athlete.
So Danny White runs the ball out of bounds inside the 30 to the 29-yard line of Minnesota, first and 10. Drew Pearson on a wing right, along with Jay Salty, so two tight ends in there as Pearson goes in motion. And it's Dorsett, big hole, and dragged down by Prowse at the last moment, or he's away.
Boy, just like Tom Landry drew it up in the playbook. Tom Rafferty, 64, John Fitzgerald, 62, opening big holes that time. Good block by Newhouse, as you see right there. There's the block by Rafferty. Give him just a piece of daylight before he's brought down by Paul Krause there. Take a look at it now again. That's picture book there. Riding Sutherland out there and cutting back against the grain. There's Rafferty's block there. There's the good tackle there, the saving tackle by Paul Krause.
First and 10 from the 16-yard line of Minnesota. And here goes Robert Newhouse. Rafferty trying to lead the way for him, and he actually ran up Rafferty's back and then spun off to the left.
Newhouse having his best season, I guess, since his sophomore season.
Well, you might take a moment or two out from this ball game, and your prayers would certainly be appreciated for that poor soul being taken out. The gentleman who, one way or another, was on fire, as you saw.
In the world could something like that happen, man.
And pray for his welfare. Second and 7 from the 13. Second man is Dorsett, and he's across the 10. Up the middle, center John Fitzgerald tried to open up the hole for him. Ralph Neely, who will retire at the end of the year after 13 years, as we look at Tom Landry. Neely has an old horseshoe nailed atop his locker, and although there will not be much of a ceremony, we understand that when he retires, the horseshoe will go down and he will give it to John Fitzgerald, the Dallas center, and another tradition is alive in Dallas. Third and 4 from the 10. Staubach going high down the middle, flag on the play. He had both Dorsett and Dupre down there. And it might be against Prowse.
It will be against Prowse. He hooked him and almost tackled him that time. He had his just completely looked like he was trying to tackle him around the waist that time.
So the veteran, Paul Krause, 14 years. Guilty, and we can take a look at it.
Oh, Krause, who's tied in once and now with 79 career interceptions. That time was feet.
We have a holding defense.
Look at the time he has to throw there. Good passing lane right there. You didn't get to see it. Dupree is just so big and so physical. Last week he outmuscled a Bear receiver for touchdown.
So it'll be first and goal from the 5. And the Cowboys leading 6-0. Scored early in the first quarter, and with 11:45 in the second quarter, try to do it again. Jay Saldi along with Dupre. Now two tight ends are in there. Pearson on a wing left. And it'll be Robert Newhouse. And Newhouse goes barreling across. And the Cowboys have done the one thing that Minnesota feared. They have gotten out in front, and it seems almost impossible that Minnesota can come back. With Rafferty and Donovan looking for the St. Patrick's Day parade, open up the hole.
From behind, we'll see the big blocks there. Pat Donovan and Rafferty, probably the two best linemen on the Dallas team. Look at the determination of Newhouse. He wants in that colored grass there, brother.
So the key, of course, was that run by Danny White out of punt formation. Now Herrera trying to get it up and through, and does. And the Dallas Cowboys leading the Minnesota Vikings 13-0. We have 11 minutes and 41 seconds left to go in the second quarter here at Texas Stadium in Irving. Robert Newhouse catching his breath after a 5-yard plunge for a touchdown. The Dallas Cowboys leading 13-0. Efren Herrera will be kicking off. Manfred Moore is deep. The key play, Danny White running out of punt formation to pick up a first down inside the Minnesota 30. That kept the drive alive. And it'll be handled by Sammy White. And White still going to the 40, to the 45 before he is dragged down. Huther and Brown making the tackle. So Tom Landry has seen his Cowboys get out in front, 13-0. And on the message board, the Cowboys and Vikings and all Americans wishing a very happy new year to Senator Hubert Humphrey.
Vikings again with excellent field position. It's almost imperative they put something on the board now and get back in the ball game.
It was a fine return, 37 yards by Sammy White. First and 10 from the 48. White goes right, Ahmad Rashad left. Play action fake to Miller, who stays in the block. And Lee going high and deep for Sammy White. No good. A flag on the play. Charlie Waters and Benny Barnes evidently interfering with Sammy White inside the 10-yard line.
If there's any question as to how strong Bobby Lee's arm is, look at it right here. Not only did he throw it a long way, I think he was looking for somebody on the left side. He throws it up there so tremendously high. Look at it, he didn't come into the picture yet. And he threw it from the top of the stadium, and you can see clearly see the interference there on water.
Sammy White had to wait for the ball, and by that time they caught up to him and bumped him. That is the first penalty against Dallas. There has been only one penalty against the Vikes. So remember, the Dallas Cowboys had it first and goal from the 5 and punched it over. Now it's first and goal from the 8 for Minnesota. That's a 44-yard gain on that interference. White goes left, Rashad right. And Bob Lee trying to get the Vikings back in the game. Another fumble, but Foreman recovered it. And he just did get it back because Jethro Pugh just missed scooping it up.
No turnovers last week at all. We'll see the ball pop loose here, I believe. Before exchange of center, he almost lost it there. That's what the problem was. Lee never got control of it, trying to hand it to Foreman.
Bounced right by Jethro Pugh up into Chuck Lapp that time, or they turn it over again. That's a little late for that now. It is second and goal from the 7. Foreman inside the 5. It's hard to believe they could not have a turnover in the rain and mud and then handle the ball so loosely here today, unless there's some kind of a lack of concentration.
That's what it has to be, and a weary team will make mistakes like that, and they obviously are tired. Last week, of course, they ran so well to the left side off the blocks of Goodrum and Steve Riley. They're doing the same thing today. Who are you going to give it to but a guy? Look at the determination in Chuck Foreman. He's got to get both his legs wrapped up before he's going to stop on you.
Third and goal from the 4. White and Rashad are left. Play action fake to Foreman. Lee under a rush by Randy White.
Whoa.
And White decks him at the 16-yard line. They lose 12 yards on the play.
Play action fake that time, and I didn't quite understand what for.
I don't believe anybody was fooled. That's Bob Lee. I don't understand why the Randy White just took a strong inside rush that time. Boy, he's an athlete. He's going to get better and better and better.
By the way, the Cowboys led the conference with 53 sacks this year. So we'll have a field goal attempt by Fred Cox. They'll spot it at the 22, a 32-yard effort by Cox. It is good.
How about boys,
Fred Cox, who will retire at the end of the year and is the second greatest scorer in history behind George Blanda, gets Minnesota on the board with 9:57 to the half, 13-3 Dallas. Four plays, 38 yards, resulting in a 32-yard field goal by Fred Cox. The sack by Randy White took all the air out of a possible touchdown balloon. And now Fred Cox starts it and squirts one low on the ground. Picked up there by Larry Brinson. He's to the 30 and goes underneath Nate Allen at the 31-yard line in a pretty good slide. Say, friends, we're going to be televising the final rounds of the Grand Prix Masters in Madison Square Garden in New York. The field of eight headed by Guillermo Vilas, Jimmy Connors, and Bjorn Borg. Field of eight chosen based on a year-long point system that included 76 major tournaments throughout the world, including Wimbledon and the United States Open. Competing for a $100,000 first prize Saturday at 3 p.m. Eastern, Sunday at 4. Here comes Dorsett. And Fred McNeil hit him at the ankle. Flag on the play. McNeil, number 54, trying to stop Dorsett, and it'll be a holding call against Dallas. In favor of the Cowboys.
Boy, in these championship games, you just can't make mistakes. You think about that now, though. On the punt to Benny White,
we have holding number 64, Hawkins.
A fumble sets up Dallas's first score, and then a fake punt sets up a second. You just can't afford any mistakes in these games.
There's a lot at stake as the ball is put on the Dallas 22. First and 20. That's Newhouse in motion. And there goes Dorsett. However, Fred McNeil, as he fumbles, but Dallas recovers. Fred McNeil did a good job of taking the block by Fitzgerald and Rafferty. He was able to tie them up, and on the fumble, Minnesota unable to come up with it.
Jim Marshall, number 70, takes a strong inside rush. You see him there. They've got him. That's exactly what they wanted to do. They got Rafferty pulling right here. Dorsett. There's where you see he's a rookie. He went too far outside. The hole was there. And then he fumbled on in addition to that before it was recovered by John Fitzgerald.
Second and 18 for the Cowboys, leading 13-3. Butch Johnson at wide left. Drew Pearson wide right. And Staubach in a run. And they try to make a sandwich of him. McNeil was the first man to hit him.
But a Cowboy getting up pretty slow, too, Ben. That's Dorsett again.
Dorsett is limping on that play. There he goes.
They told him they're going to limp on the field, not off. Hey. Roger Staubach, probably the most effective thing he does. He only does it three or four times a game, but how many first downs has he picked up running with a football? That's that added dimension. And just think, it wasn't that many years ago they said the quarterback that runs the ball can't play very long.
Well, they load up the shotgun, third and 13 from the 29. Preston Pearson staying in to block. Staubach with plenty of time, still looking. Jim Marshall can't get him. But now he unloads and completes it to Golden Richards, and they gang tackle him out of bounds. Jim Marshall had Staubach in the backfield, and Roger just did get away with checking the time to see how long he had, almost 4.5 seconds. And we'll add to that for a total of almost 10 seconds for Roger Staubach before he threw the ball. 10 seconds.
Yes, sir. And didn't find anybody open. Tony Hill was about 30 yards behind anybody, but Roger couldn't have got it there with a cannon. Virtually no pass rush. The Vikings have been troubled with that all year. Outside of Eller, they really haven't had a first-rate pass rusher. Alan Page is going to have to come alive.
Well, Danny White figures to punt it this time, and he does. And it's Manfred Moore backtracking to his own 24. End of story.
Gracious.
Jay Saldy hit him first, number 87. And there's Saldy just now getting up. Who did he hit him?
He's been a valuable player to the Cowboy team, brother.
He's paid a price for it, however. You usually do when you come down there in a bandit like that. Tony Dorsett, 4 yards a carry, limped off the field. He has had three pretty good shots so far in this game, but he just nodded as if to say, yes, I'm okay. Meanwhile, Jay Saldy, who made that tackle, is still down, number 87. We might take another look as Manfred Moore is trying to get out of the way. Saldy hit him on the left ankle, and then the rest of the Cowboys came in, so Saldy took the beating since he was the bottom man. By the way, we have a moment to tell you, and I'm sure you are concerned, the gentleman we saw literally in flames, and the flames were smothered, and he was taken out of the stadium. The preliminary report is he is at the hospital. He is coherent. He is not in too much pain. Evidently, he was dressed something like a snowman, and an unofficial report said a cigarette ash evidently set fire to his costume. So we pray for his safety.
Back to Jay Saldy. That might be a bigger injury than you'd know. He's very instrumental in some of the Dallas formations. They use him quite a bit when they use a double tight end situation, not just on short yardage plays. He's an offensive weapon for them.
Looked like his right knee that was banged up on it. First and 10 from the 23 for the Vikings. Chuck Foreman gets across the 25, but there's a flag on the play. Illegal motion going against Minnesota to jam up the work. This has been basically a penalty-free first half. However, suddenly now the flags are starting to drop.
Illegal motion, number 44, offense.
So Chuck Foreman in motion as we look at Jay Saldy and that right knee bothering him. So we'll see if 87 can get back into this one. So the Vikings have it on their own 18, first and 15. Fake to Robert Miller and a pass to Foreman coming out of the backfield. Gets across the 25 and is taken down there. So he still had plenty of yardage to go before a first down. Hitting him was D.D. Lewis.
Ben, I think I'm right in this. In the three games that Bob Lee has been quarterbacking the Vikings, I think he's only completed two passes to Chuck Foreman. He likes to go upfield with his wide receivers a whole lot more than, say, Fran Tarkenton would if he'd be in the game.
Yes, the second reception was by Foreman in the mud in Los Angeles prior to today. So it's second and six in the 27. There goes Robert Miller with Foreman trying to block. Henderson hit him and slowed him up. And that's all the Cowboys needed for somebody to slow up a runner. And Charlie Waters, along with Randy White, over to bring him down.
Miller, a pretty good-looking ball player, had seen very limited playing time this year until McClanahan had the knee surgery about a week or so ago. Runs with a great deal of authority. Look at this. Good amount of determination. I like him. Good pass receiver, too. Probably better receiver than McClanahan.
So Bob Lee trying to move the Vikes. A third down situation on his own 29 as Tom Landry looks on. Third and four. Foreman. And he needed a lot of effort to get that far because it appeared as if he was going to be stopped at the 30. And he fought his way out and get a first down. So mark that one in tribute to Chuck Foreman.
The great ball carrier, somehow, some way, they find a way. Chuck Foreman's one of those guys. He just rolls when he's hit, knows where the first down markers are. Watch him this time as he rolls off to the side there. He's a spinner, all right. Second effort, got him.
Foreman, of course, three consecutive 1,000-yard years as we look at a bad right knee of Jay Saldy. First and 10, Vikings. Lee looking right, telling his man to go deeper. His man is Sammy White, and he just went out of bounds in pursuit of the ball.
A good idea that time, that little sideline and go, because Harris was there in the coverage, though. There's a guy that can really hurt you right there. The balls he does catches, he gets some yardage out of them and a lot of touchdowns. Nine to be exact this year.
So Bob Lee, and of course all you have to do is look around here and realize it's Cowboy country. They refer to the defense now as Doomsday Junior. Second and 10 from the 34. 13-3 Cowboys. 5:08 to the half. Chuck Foreman going outside a Miller block, but it banged up there as he got across the 35. He bobbled the ball, but evidently recovered it. D.D. Lewis thought he had it and threw it high in the air. D.D. Lewis came up with the football, and D.D. was double dangerous, but slung it out of here.
Watch D.D. Lewis play off the block. Last week, he had an interception and a fumble recovery. He's been a good, steady performer for the Cowboys. You don't hear as much about him. You see how he strung it out that time. The ball did come loose.
Harvey Martin holding on to his hips as the ball went flying, and Bud Grant wondering about the thing that has haunted Minnesota all year, turnovers, and they are sure playing fast and loose with the leather in this first half. Third and 7 from the 37. Lee under a rush, but gets it away and completes it to Ahmad Rashad, and Mark Washington takes him out of bounds as they pick up the first down at the 47-yard line.
Rashad, the leading receiver in the National Football Conference this year with 51 catches, had two last week, as the only wide receiver for the Vikings to make a reception last week. More of the short range, only averaging about 12 yards. He's got better speed than that. He's been their control receiver for the Vikings.
The first Minnesota fumble has been the most damaging, that by Robert Miller. And, of course, that really led to the first Dallas touchdown, so it's a little closer than that 13-3 score would indicate. Lee trying to pick up another if he can. Fakes once, slings it and completes it to the tight end, Stu Voigt. He's inside the 35-yard line of Dallas, brought down by Cliff Harris. But Stu Voigt, the tight end, making the reception.
You had to wonder how long it was going to be before he went to Stu Voigt. Bob Lee is going to get a lot of double coverage on Sammy White and Ahmad Rashad. They're going to double both sides. He's got to go to that middle area sometime. That time you saw him do it. Stu Voigt, a good dependable receiver, if nothing more.
So he got it to the Dallas 34-yard line. First and 10, Minnesota. They started on their own 23. Sammy White, wide left. Ahmad Rashad, wide right. Forming the deep man in the eye. Both backs go out, and Lee down the left side, a diving catch and a good catch by Sammy White. First down at the 19. Sammy White making a marvelous diving catch.
Sammy White with a big inside move that time. Watch him as he comes in toward the post and then back outside. There's a little inside move right there. He gets Kyle turned all the way around that time. Look at the reception here. And yes, he was inbound. Tried. Look at it again. Bob Lee with excellent pass protection that time. Drifting in there, finding his passing lane. See those hips hit? Perfectly legitimate reception.
First and 10 from the Cowboy 19-yard line. Sammy White on the right side, and Lee faking to Foreman. Throwing it away. Sammy White covered by Barnes along with Charlie Waters. So he just threw it out of bounds. That stops it with 3:23 to the half. Second and 10 on the 19. And you look at Bob Lee's numbers.
See how long his arms are, Ben. When he puts them down, they hang down about his knees.
Bob Lee, at one time, played City College of San Francisco. Another member of that backfield was O.J. Simpson. He eventually went to the College of Pacific. So it is second and 10 from the 19. Slot left, right inside Rashad. Bob Tucker is the tight end on the right side. And it's a draw to Foreman. Is that eaten up? Cliff Harris and Bob Brunig played that as if they had the Minnesota playbook behind the line of scrimmage.
I love to watch Cliff Harris play. He's just about as reckless as anybody you want to see. And so many times when they use that safety blitz, you see him on the left there coming in on the blitz. They'll blitz that middle linebacker, too. Both of them got in on the action that time. They just guessed right that time.
So it's a third down and a long 11 for Bob Lee and the Vikings. 2:50 to the half. 13-3 Dallas. Grimm is wide left with White in the slot. Rashad is wide right. Lee gets by. Two calls. Fumble. The ball is still loose. It was Too Tall Jones applying some pressure. And it would appear as if Charles Goodrum, number 68, fell on the ball for Minnesota at the 20-yard line, and they're still having trouble holding on to the football.
I can't help but believe that was a preconceived play. I think the quarterback draw was on that time. And Bob Lee, although he doesn't run very often, fully intended to run with that.
Well, he's been in the red. He carried 12 times for a minus 8 yards, so you didn't figure to see him run much. They will spot the ball at the 27-yard line for Fred Cox, but he's faced with a 37-yard field goal kick when we come back to it. Timeout on the field with 2 minutes left to go to the half. The Dallas Cowboys leading 13-3. Fred Cox got Minnesota on the scoreboard, kicking a 32-yard field goal. And just before the two-minute warning, he was going to try another. So on a fourth and 11, Fred Cox will try his second. From the Dallas bench, Jay Salty has a sprained knee, unsure if he'll return. Tony Dorsett, a bruised heel, he will be back. Down at the 37, Cox gets it up, and it's good. And Fred Cox, who at one stage of his career kicked a field goal in 31 consecutive games, has kicked two today, and it has narrows it now to the Cowboys 13 and the Vikings 6. Fred Cox, a doctor of chiropractics, and he will go back to that career once he hangs up his spikes.
Ah, you're a doll.
Charlie Waters' doll. Boy, he's popular down here. They like it.
So you look at two things, the fumble by Miller, the recovery by Harvey Martin that led to the 32-yard touchdown pass to Golden Richards, and Danny White running out of punt formation for a first down inside the Minnesota 30. Those are the two big plays that define the difference, 13-6.
No, Fred Cox hasn't been having that good a year kicking the ball, but if it comes down to a field goal in the closing minutes, I know of no one I'd rather have kick it than Fred Cox.
Cox was 8 for 17 during the regular year. And he has inspired Minnesota that they are anything but out of the game. They spotted the Cowboys the touchdowns, but he has kept them in it. 13-6 and Fred kicking off. And again, a knuckleball down the left side. And once more, picked up by Larry Brinson. And Brinson can't get underway as he goes smothered to the ground at the 25-yard line. So the Cowboys will put it in play. Their reminder, Challenge of the Sexes returns Sunday, January 8th at 1 p.m. Eastern. Exciting man versus woman. And January 8th show, you'll see tennis, Virginia Wade versus Peter Carolitis. Water ski trick jump, Pam Folsom versus Rusty Stifler. And a motorcycle jump off, Debbie Lawler and Rex Blackwell. I know Phyllis, just as glad as I am that the show is back on. Along with the NBA on CBS. Regional games premiering. But play back in. We'll talk about basketball a little later. Robert Newhouse. Jeff Wright got him from behind as he got to the 30-yard line and fell forward. 1:40 left to the half. 13-6 Dallas. Ball on the Cowboy 31-yard line. Both teams with three timeouts left. A second and 5. Staubach getting his time, throws and completes to Drew Pearson, and he goes out of bounds just beyond the 42-yard line, picks up the first down.
Year in and year out, one of the most consistent receivers in the National Football League is Drew Pearson. Another thing about Roger Staubach, you say what you want to about all the great quarterbacks with 2 minutes remaining, but I think he's as good as anybody moving that ball against the clock.
Talking about a clock, if you remember a moment ago, we put a stopwatch on Roger, and on that scrambling play, he had 10.5 seconds before he got rid of the ball. You could read two chapters of War and Peace. First and 10 from the 43. Staubach out of the shotgun. Dorsett staying in, but he doesn't have anybody to block. Now he hits Marshall to keep him away. And the pass released to the tight end, Billy Joe Dupree. And Jeff Wright met him head on along with Jeff Seaman. First down.
Oh, it's a big
target. Rodgers Staubach improvising a little bit. All the primary receivers are covered. When that happens, those receivers are supposed to move around, find the open zones in there. Minnesota primarily a zone team. There you see Billy Joe Dupree is a big target. Roger goes right through it. Look at this impact here. Big old strong boy.
At halftime, Phyllis, Brad, and Irv will be with us, so stay right with us. There's a lot to the story of Dallas versus Minnesota here in Irving, Texas.
Phyllis back home.
Yeah, sure. She's from Denton,
Texas. Just a ways up the road. I got lost the other night and ended up there. Close to it. I've been lost since I've been down here.
You got lost, but you were making good time.
We have 53 seconds left to go to the half. The ball on the Minnesota 41-yard line where the Cowboys will put it in play, first and 10. Dallas leading 13-6. And, of course, the winner goes to New Orleans for the Super Bowl against Denver.
Vikings have been to 4 Super Bowls. I think Dallas 3 Super Bowls. Isn't that right?
Yeah, and the Minnesota, of course, 0-4. Well, first and 10. Staubach has 53 seconds. And they load up the shotgun again. Dorsett backs off to block for him. Along with Preston Pearson. And a big rush put on by Alan Page. And Page gesturing to Staubach. And Matt Blair comes over to say something to Staubach. Well, we'll wait for the official's call. Intentionally grounding the football, perhaps.
They were trying to hit Tony Dorsett that time, coming the late pattern coming out of the backfield. Well, I believe it was, Matt Blair had the coverage that time. Didn't fool anybody at all. Roger just took the safe way out. Cost him some yardage that time, though.
Well, it comes as no surprise to you that they don't like the call here in Dallas.
There's Alan Page breathing at his neck. Roger said, I better unload my shotgun about right now.
He just got it over Matt Blair's head to hit the ground. So that puts it back on the 44-yard line of Dallas, where it is second and 25. Butch Johnson is wide right, Drew Pearson left. Here comes Matt Blair, but the throw is to Preston Pearson. And he's to the 45, to the 40, to the 30. Wally Hilgenberg brought him down inside the 25-yard line. Dallas asking for timeout, 38 seconds to the half.
Preston Pearson, as you all know, one of the better receivers coming out of the backfield in all of football. Roger Staubach reaching in the bag and coming up with a little trick play, the old jump pass. Watch almost all the linemen outrun Preston. This is his last year. Hadn't run for 2 weeks until yesterday. Hadn't hurt him too awful much. Look at that Dallas precision. When they do execute, they are a thing of beauty.
42 yards. Preston Pearson bumped into Pat Donovan, and that gave Wally Hilgenberg the extra step, and Hilgenberg dragging him down from behind at the Minnesota 24-yard line. The timeout, a reminder, the 1978 CBS Sports Spectacular, presenting an exciting calendar of outstanding events in January. World Light Heavyweight Championship, defending champion Miguel Cuejo and Matei Farloff. The World Lightweight Championship, Roberto Duran defending his title against Esteban De Jesus. And Super Skates, plus the Hollywood Stuntmen competition, and much more. Be sure to watch the 1978 CBS Sports Spectacular, beginning Saturday, 4:30 p.m. Eastern Time.
Give my monkey a banana.
The Darwin Theory lives in Dallas. Yeah, it do.
The Beauty and the Beast. Oh, and there are some lovelies, too.
Dallas, Texas.
Yes, sir.
First and 10, as the Cowboys have moved it to the Minnesota 24-yard line, 38 seconds to the half. Roger Staubach sends Golden Richards in a slot inside Drew Pearson. He has Dorsett on a wing. Preston Pearson and now Dorsett come back. Roger looking down the left side and throwing to Richards. No good. Golden Richards had already left the end zone when he made the reception. Down there with him was Nate Wright and Paul Krause. So Richards, who scored a touchdown on a 32-yard pass from Staubach, this time simply ran out of real estate.
Let's see if we can see his pattern. It's an in-and-out pattern designed to go right where it was thrown. Roger Staubach could not throw it much better than this. Was there any chance at all of him keeping his feet in the bounds? Let's see. Yes,
no.
There probably was. If he did. Raymond Berry could have. Raymond Berry could have.
So second and 10 on the 24. 32 seconds to the half. 13-6 Dallas. Pearson and Butch Johnson in a slot left. Dorsett on a wing left. And now he and Pearson come back again to block. Staubach looking left. And there's a flag on the play as he throws to Billy Joe Dupre out of his hand. And he took a lick from Nate Wright. But a flag on the play.
The flag hit Herbert Scott on the back, so I would assume Herbert Scott was guilty of holding.
Once again, I'm inaccurate.
Well, we'll see.
I'm curious to see what this is going to be.
It's going to be against Minnesota. Is it ever? To the 12-yard line. Let's listen.
Personal foul. Head slapping. Number 77. Defense. First down.
Well, you heard it. The identification would be young Mark Mullaney, who was guilty of the head slap.
Seeing more and more playing time in there for Jim Marshall in passing situations.
So first and 10 from the 12-yard line, 24 seconds to the half. Pearson and Dorsett, back of Roger Staubach. Roger over the middle to Preston Pearson, and he's inside the 5-yard line. Jeff Seaman and Fred McNeil bring him down. Clock running, as you see. And now they call timeout. So let's take another look at that play in slow motion.
So many times you've seen Preston Pearson come out of the backfield. Everybody knows they're going to throw to him, but he has a way of getting open. Working between the linebackers, there's none any better. Look at the linebacker play of Minnesota Vikings. Two fine linebackers in McNeil. And who did we have in there that time with McNeil?
Jeff Seaman.
Seaman, yeah.
So 9 seconds to the half as Tom Landry huddles with his team. Dallas, by taking this timeout, has expended their three. It is 13-6 Dallas. Minnesota needed a lift, and the lift they have gotten, two field goals from Fred Cox. Cowboys scored on a 32-yard pass to Golden Richards and a 5-yard run for a touchdown by Robert Newhouse.
Should they choose to go for one more play rather than take the field goal, they can get themselves in some trouble should Roger Staubach be sacked and not come away with nothing at all.
Well, they are not going to go for the field goal, to listen to the looks of things. Roger, having talked to Tom Landry, Jeff Seaman, meanwhile, came over to talk to Bud Grant. With Wally Hilgenberg and Jim Marshall standing on the side, you see Jeff Seaman in the right-hand corner going back. So he's carrying the defensive story for the Minnesota Vikings. Seaman, out of Stanford.
Been plagued by injuries all year. Studwell's been playing... Well, several games I saw. He played some ball in there. Studwell, good-looking rookie for him.
Minnesota, by the way, was third against the pass. So we'll see. Second and 2 from the 4-yard line. Roger looking left, hesitate, punts, and throws it over the head of Drew Pearson with Bobby Bryant right there with him. Well, that didn't take long. We got 5 seconds left.
Roger, obviously disappointed that time. What a determined individual he is. Rather.
Efren Herrera will be asked to kick the field goal. He kicked 3 against Chicago for an NFC record, tying Fritsch and Knight and David Ray. And Herrera in field goals, 18 for 29. His longest 52 yards. And the kid from Guadalajara kicks it through. So the Cowboys do not walk away empty-handed. with 3 seconds to go in the half. Put a little taco sauce on that one. It's Cowboys 16 and the Vikings 6. Efren Herrera out of UCLA. So he has one, Fred Cox has two, and it could very well still come down to a battle of the kicking game. The big thing for Minnesota at this stage, they have to convince themselves that they can hold on to the football because turnovers have been a most important part of this first half. Herrera will be kicking. Manfred Moore is the deep man. Robert Miller is short on his left. Sammy White to his right. And we'll see whether Herrera gives Manfred Moore a chance to return it. 16-6 in favor of Dallas here in the first half. And Herrera bangs it up the middle, and it's fielded there by Mark Keller. He's to the 40-yard line, and down he goes. Brown and Hegman along with Aaron Kyle. The three Cowboys will wrestle him down, and the half is history. So the Dallas Cowboys leading the Vikings by 10 as they go to the clubhouse. Dallas 16, the Vikings 6.
This football trophy is made of coal. It commemorates a team of miners called the Pottsville Maroon. Back then, the ball was fatter, not much different than the helmet, a piece of old leather. You went 60 minutes in a shirt and shoes, anybody's. Today, sleeker football is made for passing, and colorful uniforms cover a lot more protection. Football has come a long way, and it's all here waiting for you at the Pro Football Hall of Fame in Canton, Ohio. Don't miss it.
Hi, this is Pat Summerall. I'm looking at a sample copy of the official Super Bowl XII game program that we'll be using when CBS Television brings you the exclusive coverage of Super Bowl XII on January the 15th from New Orleans. This program will have scouting reports, photos and lineups for both teams, a week-by-week review of the entire 77 season, plus a special section featuring the most valuable players from the past 11 Super Bowls. For your souvenir copy, send $250 to Super Bowl XII, Winona, Minnesota, 55987. Allow 6 weeks for delivery. This is a souvenir that the whole family will enjoy.
Well, hi, everybody. Vin Scully, along with Alex Hawkins, welcoming you back to the second half. The Cowboys leading the Vikings 16-6. Fred Cox kicking off to the deep men, Butch Johnson and Larry Brinson, and it'll be Brinson from the 13, slips and down he goes, shy of the 25, a fumble, and the indication is that Dallas recovered. And meanwhile, a player hurt, Bruce Huther, is down on the 40-yard line. So Huther shaken up. By the way, in seeing Huther down, it reminds us Jay Saldy was in on that kickoff return. So evidently the right knee is not that badly injured that he could not continue. Here are some of the numbers that tell part of the story of the first half. The Minnesota Vikings have had good field position in the first half. 5 of 6 times they've managed to come up with 2 field goals by Fred Cox. The biggest single gain for Minnesota would be a 44-yard pass interference play that set up Cox's second field goal. There's Bruce Huther shaking his head and hobbling off, and that right leg turned into jelly. So Efren Herrera comes out along with Bob Brunig to see if he's okay. So Huther evidently taking a lick of the timeout.
You know, when you talk about the Dallas Cowboys, you speak of the free agents, and somehow every year they come up with a couple of them. Well, Bruce Huther is one of them they came up with this year, one of two that made the ball club again this year for the Dallas Cowboys.
Fans bundled up. It was 30 degrees when the game started. It might be colder now. Bruce Huther is a rookie out of New Hampshire. So the Cowboys will put it in play. First and 10 on their own 28-yard line, leading 16-6. Butch Johnson in a slot right inside Drew Pearson. Dupree, the tight end on the left side. Tony Dorsett slipped and went down on his own. Matt Blair was fighting Butch Johnson at the 35-yard line, and Dorsett slipped and went down. Dorsett, who had a bruised heel, as we look at Matt Blair. Blair, Seaman, and McNeil. trying to hold on with the back four of Eller, Sutherland, Page, and Marshall. And in checking, Mullaney and Marshall, along with Page, Sutherland, and Eller. Drew Pearson, wide right. On a second and one call by Staubach. And he goes to Dorsett following Newhouse. They stack him up, so it's questionable. Dorsett had a bruised heel in the first half.
Jeff Seaman coming in and plugging up that middle very well. What's number 50 coming into your picture? About a standoff at the line of scrimmage, but look at that shot there. Jeff Seaman.
That was Newhouse trying to block him, but Seaman was too strong. He might have shuddered at impact, but he plugged it. Well, the ball at the 37-yard line. Third and one. Dorsett. They stack him up. It would appear that he got over the pack and then was pushed backwards. We'll let that decision to the referee.
Those purple people can get stubborn when they want to. Those third and short situations, goal line situations, they don't give up much. You think how they outweighed Jim Marshall? I don't believe he weighs about 225 pounds. He's outweighed giving up about 30 pounds nearly everybody he plays against, but he holds his own. Been a great performer for the Vikings.
So we'll see. And there's the story. They need that much. It is fourth down. Tom Landry leading 16-6. Let's take another look from behind the quarterback.
Dorsett not having a particularly good day today. He's been troublesome injuries, I guess. You've got to give Jeff Seaman his due, as well as the rest of that defensive front for the Vikings.
Well, on a fourth and one, Manfred Moore goes back to his own 20. Remember, Danny White burned the Vikings. He ran for 14 yards for a first down that set up the second Cowboy touchdown. This time, he'll kick it. And Moore on his own 28-yard line. Down he goes at the 30. The first man to hit him was Scott Laidlaw, number 35. That slowed him up for Tom Henderson to knock him down. So Minnesota will put the ball in play. First and 10 from their own 30. Don't forget, the 78 CBS Sports Spectacular presenting an exciting calendar of outstanding events. Next Saturday, the WBC World Light Heavyweight Championship, defending champion Miguel Cuejo and Matei Parlov. First and 10 from the Viking 30. Foreman with Miller, and he tries to get inside Yeri, and the fellow who messed that play up is Too Tall Jones, number 72.
Oh, hadn't he played a ball game today?
He fought off Ron Yeri, and that messed it all up.
Well, I talked to Cliff Harris about him the other day, and he said that is right now currently the best player on the defense for the Dallas Cowboys. Too Tall, doing a great job of forcing it, playing off a blocker, and letting that pursuit come in.
Charlie Waters and Randy White taking advantage of Too Tall, who was handling Ron Yeri. Boy, that's a day and a half work for Ron Yeri to try and block Too Tall Jones. Second and 11 from the 29. Play action fakes and Lee going high down the middle, and he's got Sammy White, and White's going out of bounds inside the 45-yard line to the 43-yard line at Dallas. Charlie Waters takes him out, but Sammy White's in business.
Oh, yes, sir. Beat the double coverage that time. They had him inside and out, and he still beat it that time. Sammy White, the deep threat of the Vikings. Watch, you run the inside and out pattern there. You see Aaron Kyle pushing him inside. You should be able to see the safety come into the play right here. Waters, I believe, right there, but he beat the coverage.
You get the feeling, and you've had it most of the day, Minnesota is okay except for Minnesota mistakes. First and 10 from the 43. They picked up 28 yards on the play. Chuck Foreman following Robert Miller to the 35, and down he goes at the 31-yard line. That time he got by Harvey Martin, and Aaron Kyle finally brought him down. Martin almost had him behind the line of scrimmage.
A lot of people have almost had Chuck Foreman, but he just keeps on keeping on. Watch him break the tackle here at number 79, Harvey Martin. He's got plenty. Look at the strength that guy's got. Dallas finally zoom in on him a little bit there.
Foreman
White with all that pursuit, the speed.
First and 10 on the Dallas 32-yard line. Sammy Johnson is going to carry, and he gets inside the 30. The same Sammy Johnson who scored a touchdown against the Rams in the mud after Foreman was banged up. Tom Landry, what a career. Overall, he has piloted Dallas to 161 victories, winner of Super Bowl VI. And in the last 12 years, he's gotten the Cowboys 11 times into the playoffs.
His record speaks for itself. What an outstanding person, and probably a misunderstood person, too. Just because he's quiet. He's got a great sense of humor, and he's a nice man, very direct.
Second and eight from the 30. And hold everything. Flags like snowflakes coming down. Illegal procedure against Minnesota. So again, it's the old story. We have met the enemy, and they are us.
Good point.
Minnesota struggling against themselves. They have played Dallas pretty well, but the Vikings are causing themselves more trouble than the Cowboys. Sammy Johnson.
Ball start. Number 78. Offense.
That would be Steve Riley trying to get a jump. They'll spot the ball at the 35, where it is second and 13. Crowd kind of quiet right now, well bundled up. The modern day picture of a crowd watching themselves on television. Second and 13 from the 35. Foreman inside. Yari slowed up and barely got across the 35. Randy White, as usual, right in the thick of things.
And so cohesive, that Dallas defense. Everybody being where they're supposed to be. Tuttle not going to let them take the outside position, playing off his block and being in on a tackle. White, Martin, the whole group.
And Foreman limping on that left leg.
That's the thing about that flex defense, Ben, that the Dallas plays so often. It takes so much time to learn it and so much discipline. Tom Landry exemplifies the discipline on this team.
They third and 12 from the 34. Lee going to the left side over the head of the intended receiver, Bob Grimm. Mark Washington over there to defend. And so Lee is bogged down as he misses Grimm. Of course, remember that illegal procedure apparently added some more yardage and took a little steam out of a possible Minnesota drive.
Lee throwing the ball a little bit high today. Several times the ball's taken off on him.
So fourth down and 12 from the 34. Tony Hill standing on his own 10-yard line. Neil Clabo punting from the Dallas 45, angling for the corner. And he couldn't do it. So Clabo has kicked 19 inside the 20 this year, but not that time. So the Dallas Cowboys will put it in play. First and 10 from their own 20. 10 minutes and 11 seconds to go in the third. The Dallas Cowboys leading 16-6, 10 minutes and 11 seconds to go in the third quarter. And tomorrow, the eyes of Texas will be on the Cotton Bowl, as well as the rest of the nation. Undefeated Texas, the Irish of Notre Dame at 2 p.m. Eastern time tomorrow.
It'll be the best of all of those games.
It should be a whopper. Dorsett, the deep man behind Newhouse. He follows a Newhouse block and gets across the 25 to about the 28-yard line.
Boy, he just glides, doesn't it? Another year of experience, and he's going to be something to watch. Not that he's not already. Tony Dorsett.
A so picture fluid. Of Dorsett last week standing on the sidelines with an ice pack on his right knee, and then earlier in the game, he bruised his heel.
Speaking of bruises, Foreman went out with a bruised knee and should be returning.
Would you believe this game is in Dallas and not Minnesota when you see that? Second and three. And Dorsett confused, and so the Vikings make Staubach pay. Tony Dorsett, first of all, was late in the shift and very unsure. And then as he rolled in front of Staubach, he thought he was going to get the ball. You watch a young man who is confused.
Somehow you get the idea that his mind is drifting a little bit today, that he's not quite with everything.
Now he's going to block. Then he says, give me the ball. McNeil says, thank you. And then Blair and the rest of the Vikes. So Tony Dorsett. And it can happen, of course, a very complicated offense for Tom Landry. Third and three from the 27. Staubach going to put it up. Down the middle, and a great catch by Preston Pearson. Nate Allen was there all over him, and somehow Preston Pearson made the reception. Remember, he made that key 32-yard catch. That was a big play that led to Herrera's field goal.
I think you summed it up. You said somehow he made the catch. Well, that's somehow happening again and again is the way that you get the Super Bowls, making the play when you have to. Preston Pearson, how important he's been to this Dallas team over the last 2 years.
Well, Nate Allen all over him, but it didn't make any difference. It is 29 degrees here in Irving. First and 10 on the 35. Tony Dorsett, and he runs into a Viking team picture at the 35. 7 minutes, 15 seconds left to go in the third quarter. Cowboys 16, Vikings 6. In the first half, our stats unofficially, not much difference in plays. The Cowboys had the ball 30 plays, the Vikings 29. But the Cowboys forced 7 Chicago turnovers last week, and a couple of Viking turnovers were very costly in the first half today. Second and 7 from the 38. In motion, Drew Pearson. Play action fake to Dorsett. Staubach down the middle, no good. Drew Pearson had his hands on the ball, couldn't hold it. Chuck Foreman, we saw limping off the field a few moments ago, would appear to be okay as he walks up and down along the Viking bench. The ball on the 38-yard line, where it is third and 7. 61,968 here today to see whether the Cowboys or Minnesota will go to New Orleans to play Denver. Third and 7 out of the shotgun. And Staubach going high and deep. And it was Nate Wright and Paul Krause down there, along with Drew Pearson.
Boy, do you remember that same play in 1975 when these two teams met in Bloomington, the last play of the game. That was the man you're looking at, Nate Wright, who was victimized by Drew Pearson for the touchdown in that hallelujah finish.
The so-called Hail Mary pass.
Yeah, Hail Mary pass, that's right.
50
hallelujah
yards,
was close.
50-yard pass with 24 seconds left in the game.
What a finish that was.
So Danny White will punt from his own 25-yard line, and Manfred Moore standing on his 20. Vikes can't get near him. He appeared to hurry it anyway. Manfred Moore is going to have to let it roll, and it's inside the 15. Finally picked up by Jay Saldy, who felt like he wanted to touch the ball once. He took a pretty good crack on the knee earlier, you remember. We have 6 minutes and 53 seconds left to go in the third quarter. That was a 50-yard punt. It is 16-6, Dallas over Minnesota. You are looking at two future patients. You see Ralph Neely, number 73, along with center John Fitzgerald. They are each going under the knife for knee operations after the year. For Ralph Neely, it will be his fourth knee operation in his career. Boy, you got to love it. First and 10 from the 13 for Minnesota. And it is Robert Miller. And he barely got to the 10-yard line. And Harvey Martin was the man who met him, and that was the end of the story.
Dallas defense playing offense right now. Going to try to keep him in the hole and get the good field position on the exchange of punts.
In the backfield, Chuck Foreman along with Robert Miller. Of course, for the Vikings in the first half, they had good field position 5 of the 6 times they got the ball, and yet they could manage only 2 field goals. Lee throwing to Ahmad Rashad, and Aaron Kyle tried to hit him to Lubbock.
Boy, they look inspired. That Dallas defense looks fired up. They look inspired.
Kyle broke his left arm this year.
Bob Lee as he rolls out this time. Can't see anybody open over the middle there, and he goes to his left. Aaron Kyle was not fooled by it at all. Boy, there was a lick on Rashad.
So it is third and eight from the 15-yard line. Ahmad Rashad is left. Grimm wide right. Sammy White in a slot and Foreman in motion. Oh, there's a lot of movement. Well, let's see. There's an awful lot of shaking going on up front. And a legal procedure will go against Minnesota.
We have a false start. Number 78, offense. Third down.
Steve Riley, as you see right there in the picture. Left tackle there. Number one draft choice 4 years ago. They expect great things from him. And you can tell right away that's not John Madden, can't you? Uh-huh, Ben.
Third and 13. The ball on the 10-yard line. Chuck Foreman. Got it out to the 15-yard line. Riley trying to lead the way along with a block by Robert Miller, and Tom Henderson brought him down.
Tom Henderson, one of the real big playmakers, but he's not as consistent as D.D. Lewis, but he comes up with a big play so many times. Got so much speed. You saw right there, Chuck Foreman, no place to go.
So Neil Clabo will be asked to root it out from his own 5-yard line. Tony Hill standing on the Minnesota 46-yard line waiting for the football. And Clabo bangs it high. Tony Hill taking it at the 49. Matt Blair slowed him up. And at the bottom of the pile, you'll see Dumbler, and then you'll see Blaha. So Tony Hill gets it back just shy of the 40-yard line. He'll spot it at the 42 of Minnesota. 16-6, Dallas. Bud Grant, who has seen Minnesota lose the football a couple of important times in the first half, but Fred Cox has come back to keep him in the ball game. It's 16-6 Dallas.
That man is not unlike George Allen. The things he does to psych his team. Oh, you'd have thought everything was going against him. He's the only man in the world that thinks the world's against him, and he's still not paranoid.
First and 10 from the Minnesota 41-yard line. And Drew Pearson in motion to the right. Staubach crossing out. They set up a screen for Pearson, but yeah, Dud Sutherland was able to read it, and he took him down inside the 40-yard line. So Sutherland, up there along with the more famous Eller, Page, and Marshall, meeting at the sideline for the Vikes. The offensive line, that's Mick Tinglehoff. Some of the boys putting their heads together, trying to generate something when Minnesota next gets the ball. It is 16-6 Dallas. 4:24 to go in the third quarter. Second and 7 from the 38 of Minnesota. Jay Salty, a tight end with Billy Joe Dupree. There goes Dorsett. And he's inside the 30-yard line, leaving Vikings in his wake. Sutherland and Seaman finally bring him down, and a couple of Cowboys are shaken up. Rafferty very slowly getting up.
Just a big hole that time. Look at all the blocks there. Nearly missed his. That boy can get a lot of mileage, though. He is going to gain who knows how many yards before he's finished.
There's Tom Rafferty. We told you that he was shaken up. He was considered the top pulling guard in the 76 draft. He went in the fourth round for Dallas out of Penn State. 2 years. Bruce Huther got his bell rung on a kickoff. We haven't seen him since, although they tell us that he'll be okay. They're hitting pretty hard. First and 10 from the Minnesota 30. Burton Lawless in there now, double sixes instead of Rafferty. Staubach to Newhouse. And he goes just shy of the 20-yard line. Carl Eller on top of him. But I think there's a flag and a penalty holding against Dallas. Will nullify the run. Newhouse had scored a touchdown from 5 yards. The preliminary report holding against center John Fitzgerald.
Boy, as you watch the Minnesota Vikings, the poise that they have, though. So many big games they've been in, they've won their share of them, too. You won't see them do that. You'll never see them panic. Even when they should sometimes.
We have holding number 62, offense.
62, John Fitzgerald.
You see, we take a look.
Number 62 is John Fitzgerald, the guilty party. There's nothing so bad as when you're caught with the goods.
Trying to keep Doug Sutherland away from Robert Newhouse. First and 20 from the Minnesota 40-yard line. 3:26 to go in the third quarter. Golden Richards in a slot left inside Drew Pearson. Sutherland chasing Staubach. Now Marshall comes over, and Jim Marshall brings him down.
The two old-timers came into play that time. A good strong rush by Carl Eller running him out of the pocket, and then Jim Marshall with a great speed. He still has good speed. Been around so long.
Just celebrated his 40th birthday the other day.
41st, I believe, wasn't it?
Well, they have him in one book, born in 37, which would make him 40. There's another report that he was born in 36. Marshall is insane.
Around 40, those years get big, Ben. You know why? You'll cheat on one year when you get to there.
Second and 20. On the Minnesota 40-yard line. Drew Pearson wide left, Butch Johnson right. It's still Dorsett and Newhouse. Sutherland trying to get at him. They set up a screen to Newhouse, and McNeil slowed him up, and Jeff Wright brought him down. Fine play by Fred McNeil, who was shaken up, number 54. He had to break the screen to pieces, and then Jeff Wright made the hit. Fine play by Fred McNeil.
I'll say it was. He's coming on stronger than battery acid. The guy, the entire linebackers last week, played so well for the Minnesota Vikings. You might fool McKaysley not very often. Look at the play there, going over a blocker and holding on and waiting for help there.
It was Herb Scott who threw the block at him, but McNeil was able to hurdle the block. Stack up the play. That was a marvelous defensive.
You like that one, didn't you?
I love it.
That boy.
Third and 20 from the Minnesota 40-yard line. Preston Pearson in there now on a wing to the right. And Preston staying in the block. Staubach down the middle. Pearson inside the 15-yard line. There were four Vikings there, and somehow Drew caught it.
What do you say about Drew Pearson? Year in and year out, he's been a leading Cowboy receiver for 3 years in a row. When the big play comes, he makes it for the Cowboys. You see it so often. Staubach with so much time to throw. Preston Pearson staying back, trying to pick up somebody right on the money with it. I guess you could say he's on target and all those cliches. But anyhow, there's old Drew Pearson going down to about the what? 13?
Picked up 28 yards on the play. The ball spotted just shy of the 12. First and 10. Second time that Pearson has made the big reception to keep things alive for the Cowboys. Staubach to Dorsett. And Dorsett fumbles. And Minnesota recovers. Oh. And it was Jeff Wright who really laid a lick on Tony Dorsett. And the recovery by Fred McNeil. So the Minnesota Vikings find that somebody else will lose the football occasionally. It's still Dallas 16, Vikings 6.
This is Tony Dorsett's second fumble of the day. Somehow you think he just lacks some concentration today. For whatever reason, I don't know. Coughs it up right there when Jeff Wright hits him and Fred McNeil very alertly on it. A big play for the Vikings. It looked like Dallas was thinking in terms of putting it out of reach.
So the Vikings have it, first and 10 on their own 12. Miller and Foreman behind Lee. And they pitch back to Foreman. Ed Jones cut him down at the 10-yard line. Too tall is too much.
I just believe I'd leave him alone and just concentrate on running to the left, because they're not doing anything at all with him. Ron Yeary has had his hands full all day long.
Too tall Jones, number 72, is 6'9". He looks like the Colossus of Rhodes out there right now.
Too big to put in a wax museum.
What a game he is playing on the left side for Dallas.
Just in his fourth year. He's just learning the game, really.
Well, they move the ball to the 13. Second and 9. In motion goes Foreman. And Lee will throw it out to Robert Miller. Ed White is out there to block, but there's only one White, and there are three Cowboys. And Bob Brunig brings him down.
Too much Dallas defense, Ben.
One against three, not going to win very often.
They're so coordinated today. Last week they've been shopping. You know, they peaked early in the year, a lot of people thought, when they were 8-0. Lost a couple games, but they got it back together again. They're the best team in the National Football Conference, regardless how this game comes out.
Well, as far as coming out, we have 34 seconds left to go in the third quarter. Dallas leading 16-6. Dallas looking for the pass with five defensive backs on a third and eight situation. Randy White leaping in the air, so Lee had a scamper and intended for Ahmad Rashad with Barnes right there with him. It was Randy White leaping high in the air, and it made Lee leave the pocket, and he just threw it away.
Well, Bobby Lee might not do anything to cause you to win, but he isn't going to do much to cause you to lose. He throws this one away, or I like to think he does anyhow, trying to get to the left and gets chased out there. There wasn't anybody open, and he just threw it low that time. He's a very calculated player, as he displayed last week.
So the Dorsett fumble saved Minnesota on the last Cowboy drive. Now Neil Clabo has to kick. Tony Hill standing on the Minnesota 45-yard line to receive. And the Cowboys are coming, and he got it away, and Stalls knocked Clabo down. And roughing the kicker, and it'll be an automatic first down for Minnesota.
That's what happens when you have too many people rushing that putter. They hit together that time and knocked him into the kicker.
David Stalls, number 65, will loom rather prominently in your picture right there.
You saw some collision between Stalls and somebody else there, and you can't have that many people rushing the punter.
Stalls, a rookie out of North Colorado. Oh, that'll spot the ball just shy of the 20.
Running into the kicker.
He wants to go high.
Number 65, first down.
So running into the kicker, and that was a legitimate one. We have seen a few good acting jobs in the course of the year, shall we say.
Marginal calls.
That time, he was knocked down. We have 2 seconds to the end of the third quarter. It is 16-6 Cowboys, so a fumble recovery and running into the kicker. And Minnesota still alive. Foreman out of the backfield to handle a pass. He got by D.D. Lewis and carried it out to the 25-yard line. So D.D. Lewis could have ruined everything, but he avoided Lewis before Bruni could finally bring him down.
Just a lot of athlete right there.
Well, that's the end of the third quarter. As we take one more look at Bob Lee throwing to Foreman.
Okay,
there's
spins.
Lewis.
So much like Preston Pearson. Pick and roll.
The end of the third quarter. Dallas 16, Vikings 6. We now pause for a word from your local station.
11 years of hit songs from her show. One of the highlights when Steve Lawrence joins Carol Burnett and Company tonight on CBS.
If you pick an airline by the food it serves, you'll have a hard time deciding. All airline food is pretty much the same. Eastern Airlines has to do more than serve good food. Reservations has to answer the phone politely. Ground crews hustle faster. Flight attendants do even more to take care of you. And we're doing it. For the second year in a row, we've flown almost 2 million more passengers than the year before. There are other airlines you could fly besides Eastern. That's why we have to earn our wings every day.
For somebody, Dallas and Minnesota, the winner of playing the Denver Broncos. And for the Vikings now, it is second and four from the 25. Robert Miller trying to follow a Foreman block. Down he goes with Thomas Henderson on his back. By the way, this Dallas ball club, a very aggressive club. During the regular year, the Cowboys were penalized 106 times, most in Dallas history. Today, they have been penalized 4 times for 79 yards. Minnesota, 4 times for 35.
And it wasn't always that way until they got all those young players. They used to be a finesse team, offensively and defensively. In the last 2 years, they've become a very physical team.
Yeah, you come down here, they'll turn your hat inside out. Third and three from the 26. Lee looking left, throws and dropped by Stu Boyd.
Stu!
The tight end had a shot, couldn't hold on to it.
Oh, no. They've got to get a big game out of him somehow because they're doubling those outside receivers, both sides.
Stu caught 20 passes during the regular year. Meanwhile, Roger Staubach getting ready. That was a big play. Had Boyd held on to it, they pick up the first down, and they're on the move. Instead, they have to give it up. Neil Clabo will be kicking. Tony Hill standing on his own 43. They're not coming. and Claybo with plenty of time, end over end to Hill, to midfield. A hurdle over McNeil. Boy, what a jump. And he gets to the 41-yard line.
Tony Hill's just a rookie, but he's considered the best athlete on the Dallas Cowboy team, and that's saying something. Keep his name in mind. He's going to be a great football player.
Boy, what a hurdler. You'll see him go right over McNeil right there. Tony Hill, you stop.
On Monday at 2 p.m. Eastern, CBS Sports presents the Cotton Bowl with Heisman Trophy winner Earl Campbell leading the number one ranked Texas Longhorns against the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. That's Monday at 2 p.m.
The Dallas Cowboys leading the Minnesota Vikings 16-6, and the Pokes put it in play, first and 10 on the Minnesota 41. Drew Pearson goes wide right. Jay Salty, along with Billy Joe Dupree, the two tight ends, Dorsett, the deep man, back of Newhouse. And it'll be Dorsett, and Sutherland took the block from John Fitzgerald and made the tackle. Good play by Doug Sutherland, able to roll off Fitzgerald's block.
Look how poised those Vikings are. They amaze me.
We were keeping track of the number of plays. Been very close. Minnesota 48 plays, Dallas 46 right up this minute. So it's a little closer than that 16-6 that showed. Tony Dorsett not quite for a carry. Second and 9 from the 40-yard line. Full house backfield, but there goes Golden Richards in motion. Staubach getting fine protection, and he hits his man, and it is Drew Pearson who took it away from Nate Wright. Seaman and Krause finally hit him, but he's a magician, Drew Pearson.
And how about the way Roger Staubach drilled that in there? The coverage was there that time. Nate Wright had all the coverage in the world. He ran a very disciplined pattern, and Roger Staubach really unloaded this one. Throws it on the line. Look how perfect that was. Hit him right in the numbers, and I had to be there.
Staubach now has thrown the ball 19 times and completed 12.
Hook 'em, Horns. I'm going to stay over for that one, Ben.
I bet you are. Staubach has rolled up 175 yards with his passing today. Roger keeping as he rolls around. Matt Blair throws off the hands of Dupree, and it is picked off by the Vikings' Nate Wright. Right off the hand of Billy Joe Dupree, and Nate Wright makes a big interception, and the Vikings are still above water.
Well, so you didn't expect Roger to unload one like that. He's played in four NFC title games, and he's thrown four interceptions in those. That's his first of the day.
Dallas 16, Minnesota 6. The Minnesota Vikings get their second turnover in the second half. They had recovered a Tony Dorsett fumble earlier. Now they get the interception off Dupree's hand, picked off by Nate Wright. They are first and 10 on their own 4, 12:36 left to go in the game. Play action fake to Chuck Foreman, and Lee's pass is knocked down. And it looked like Larry Cole, who got his hand up, he of the anonymous game.
The Zero Club. I'll tell you, when it comes in the ball game, Larry Cole makes some big plays. Played both defensive tackle and defensive end, and has kind of a call you don't expect Bob Lee to make. He's not what you call a daring quarterback, more calculated than anything else. You see the big left hand coming up by Larry Cole. Those passing lanes, you got to move in there and find them open. Fran Garten just does it better than anybody I know.
Oh, the champ against defense now. Second and 10 from the 4 after that stop by Cole. Chuck Foreman out across the 5, just shy to the 10-yard line. Trying, if nothing else, to give Neil Claybo a little room to punt. Down at the bottom, too tall. Boy, what a game. Ed Jones.
If you had to point out one person to the outstanding player in the game, he'd have to be under strong consideration. Ed Too Tall Jones.
Too Tall, by the way, is not going to be in the Pro Bowl. Third and 5. Lee trying to hang on to the ball. Both backs release, and it's intended for Robert Miller. Bob Brunig was right there with him, and that will be that for the Vikings offense, at least for that series. Big play by Brunig. Pressure by Randy White.
Well, that Dallas defense, you got to credit them. They're keeping the heat on the Vikings. They're keeping them in their own territory, giving them no field position whatsoever. And Bob Lee just having trouble finding receivers open anywhere. Randy White, look at that. Look at the rush there. Brunick with the coverage. Nobody open.
So Tony Hill standing on the Minnesota 42-yard line. And Neil Quabo will be trying to get it out from his end zone. Mark Washington will be trying to rush him, and then he peels off. Huther comes through, and what a punt he got off. It looked like a Raymond Guy punt. Tony Hill at the 38. Got by McNeil. Still on his feet. He got by Miller. And he is finally brought down by Studwell along with McNeil.
That's my boy. That's my boy, Tony.
Oh, what an athlete.
He's an athlete. He is going to be a great receiver.
He is a rookie out of Stanford who broke Gene Washington's records out there on the coast, so you know he can play.
That tells you a little something, because he's no better than Gene Washington, I don't believe, anywhere. Look at the balance there. Somehow he senses that, too. He's got that guy. He's got to look like he's got a can breaker tool.
So Tony Hill brings it back to the Viking 43, and the Cowboys have it first and 10. Golden Richards wide left, Drew Pearson right. And Dorsett, with his back staying in, and unloads to Dupree. No catch. He short hopped the ball.
Roger won't back off much, will he? Down in front.
Don't forget the big round ball on CBS. The NBA, these regional games, Sunday, January 8th, 1:45 p.m. Boston, Philadelphia, Chicago, Denver, Los Angeles, Indiana, New Orleans versus Portland. The NBA on CBS.
Rogers not backing off at all, is he? First down, he's throwing it. Trying to increase that lead from 16 to 10, and he wants to put a little more on there.
Each team with three timeouts left. We have 11:35 left in the game. Second and 10 from the Viking 43. And it'll be Newhouse. And he just ran over Fred McNeil. But the Vikings then plugged it up. You want to see a linebacker just overrun. You'll see number 54 go down as Robert Newhouse just went right over him.
Let's see if we can find Fred McNeil here. Seaman, the block on him. This tackle in by McNeil. Wrestle down. Who is that?
Alan Page down at the bottom. McNeil turned as if they get his number. Tom Landry exhorting his team to make it to the Super Bowl. And they're leading 16-6 with 11 minutes to go. Third and 5 from the 38 of Minnesota, and Staubach loading up the shotgun. Eller trying to get him. Marshall has him. Eller tried to come in from the outside, and Marshall wrapped him up at the 45-yard line. A big defensive play by 40-year-old Jim Marshall.
Well, that's what you expect from your older players. You expect leadership in the crucial situations. That's what they get it from, Eller and Marshall, for years and years and years. Look at a big rush there by Alan Page. Marshall in on the tackle. That's funny what Bud Grant said. The older players are the hungrier players. He likes those old ones. 28 years old is what this team averages, almost 29.
Fourth and 12, Danny White will be kicking from his own 45, angling for the sidelines, and gets it out, and we'll see where they're spotted. Almost the 17-yard line. So Minnesota will put it in play. And suddenly, as usual, the clock becomes so very important. 10 minutes and 28 seconds left, and that's the story.
That's a shot of what?
Bud Grant and the Vikings in 29-degree weather here in Dallas. A reminder that CBS will televise the final round of the Grand Prix Masters from Madison Square Garden in New York, Saturday, 3 p.m. Eastern, Sunday at 4 p.m. The field of eight headed by Guillermo Vilas, Jimmy Connors, and Bjorn Borg. But right now, first and 10 from the 17 for Minnesota. Lead to Robert Miller, and down he goes. Guess who? Too tall Jones. Ron Yeary was stretched out on the ground, and the big man looms bigger and bigger as the game progresses.
And when is Bobby Lee going to learn? Stay away from too tall. He is hot today. He got the hot hand. Watch him. Let's see how he beats his block. Oh, he completely manhandles Yeary. Yeary got the inside of him, but he didn't get outside. Quick enough, he's just not quick enough to belt him.
So they lose four on the play from the 17 to the 13. It is second down and 14 yards. Here comes Cole, but he unloads to Robert Miller to the 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, and out of bounds. Robert Miller brings the ball across midfield to the Dallas 49 before Benny Barnes can knock him out of bounds. Minnesota on a big play to Miller.
Let's see what they had on that time. Because D.D. Lewis was given a strong pursuit that time. Good pass rush by Dallas. Unloads it, and there's just so much room to run there. Boy, that's what Minnesota needed to get out of that hole. Now you got some working room. Get back in here.
38 yards on that completion to Robert Miller. First and 10, Minnesota on the Dallas 49-yard line. We have 9 minutes and 42 seconds left. It is 16-6, Dallas. The 6 points for Minnesota, 2 field goals by Fred Fox. And Sammy White in motion to the right. Out to Sammy White. They try to set up a screen. And he is stacked up by two tall Jones who got him from behind. Number 72, he has been everywhere.
Watch the force this time by Charlie Waters. Number 41, watch him come into the picture. Sammy White in motion there, steps back. Gary out here in blocking position. Waters does his job, though. He turns it into flow, and too tall there again.
So too tall Jones, 26 years old, 4 years out of Tennessee State, 6'9", 265. He has been awesome. From the 46-yard line, the Vikes put it in play. Second down for Bob Lee. Both backs go out. Good block by Yeri that time, and the pass, good. Intended for Bob Grimm, and Charlie Waters almost knocked him out of his uniform.
Cliff Harris approves of that, too. Between the two of them, I don't know of any team that has any better safeties. Charlie
Grimm
Waters
is the perfect name for the guy who took that lick.
You tell it. You tell it. There's old Cole in there. Too tall fell down on the play, enabling Bob Lee to get outside. Look at this hit coming in. Dude, that's smart.
Well, why they don't get a whiplash, you never know when they're hit from behind like that. Too tall Jones, by the way, when he went down alongside Ron Yeri, might have hurt his hand a little bit. It is third and 7 from the 46. Foreman and Miller go out, and Lee, running for his life, unloads to Foreman. And Henderson tripped him up as he fell across the 45-yard line. Not enough for the first down. Thomas Henderson just did get him from behind, and that saved it. Otherwise, they have the first down.
Well, I agree with you. We had some running room at the time. You put Chuck Foreman out in an open field, you don't know when you're going to get him stopped. Bob Lee having to do an improvise a little bit there, which is not his long suit. Randy White containing him in the pocket there and giving some chase. The footing must be awful bad today for some reason or another. Look at this great save there by Henderson. Kyle finishing him off.
He missed the first down by about 3.5 yards. So they'll have to give up the ball. Neil Clabo. Again, angling for the sideline, but the ball seems to hook back to Tony Hill, and the fair catch is called at the 12.
You called that, and it
funny
was really
kind of
true.
A kick, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
Looked like he was aiming for the sidelines, and the ball just seemed to hook on him. That's Randy White. And by the way, they are all playing for this one. Super Bowl 12, Sunday, January the 15th, 6 p.m. Eastern Time from the Superdome in New Orleans. And the NFL today will be on from 4:30 to 6 preceding. It'll be the Denver Broncos against either Dallas or Minnesota. 7:54 left in this. Cowboys first and 10 on their own 13. Tony Dorsett and Matt Blair wrapped him up as he crossed the 10-yard line. Dorsett unofficially has carried the ball 17 times for 58 yards. There's Fred McNeil. He's played a hard game.
Something you don't see too much of is injured Viking players. You know, you do their team at the first of the year, and they'll come up at the end of the year with the same starting lineup, and you wonder how they go so injury-free so many years.
Second and 11, the ball on the 12-yard line. 16-6 Dallas, 7:13 left in the game. Roger off the hands of Jay Saldy. Salty, who had hurt his right knee very early in the game, could not quite hold on to it. So Jay comes out. He's a good-looking guy out of South Carolina, and the odd thing about Jay Salty, he was the only rookie free agent to stick with Dallas, the free agent in 76. So he's had to do it the hard way. Third and 11, the ball on the 11. 7 minutes and 8 seconds left. Timeouts left, three for each side. The Minnesota trying to stop Staubach now out of the shotgun and get their hands on the ball again. And it was intended for Drew Pearson, I believe, and he lost his balance. Drew and Nate Wright seemed to bump a little, and Drew almost went down. No interference called. So on a fourth and 11, the Vikings stiffen, and Randy White will have to kick it out. So the Vikings should be in pretty good field position now. Manfred Moore standing at midfield. Blaha to his left and Grimm to his right. And Danny White, who made a very big play early in the game when he ran for a first down out of punt formation. You can see he asked to punt for the seventh time. He punted 83 times. High snap, but he got it away. And he hangs it. Moore at his own 49, felt it, and it is recovered by Jay Salty. What a guy who hit him. One of the most hellacious hits of the year, Thomas Henderson.
What a shot he gave him that time.
Jay Salty got the ball for a moment. I thought he had Manfred Moore's head.
Salty's so active on those kicking teams. You remember in New York when he picked up one and ran it for a touchdown. Look at the shot by Tom Henderson. As I say, a big play man. D.D. Lewis on his spot, but Jay Salty beats him good.
So another turnover and a most important one, especially now, a 40-yard punt. And on that lick by Henderson, the fumble by Manfred Moore, recovered by Jay Salty. The Cowboys have it first and 10 on the Viking 35-yard line. 6:50 left to go. Staubach giving to Newhouse. Newhouse upended by Bobby Bryant, who just threw a block at him to upend him at the line of scrimmage, and the little guy just kept flying for a while.
Now, Vin Scully will find out if the Cowboys have any killer in them right now, because they can ice this game with a touchdown right here for all practical purposes with just 6 minutes to go.
By the way, in looking at Robert Newhouse, everybody comments on his legs, the size of his thighs. Tex Schramm wanted it pointed out. 26 inches, the thighs of Robert Newhouse. There goes Newhouse again, just running over people inside the 20, down to the 15-yard line, just leaving people in his wake. Tom Rafferty doing a great job on the trap. And Newhouse barrels to the 15.
Sheer determination by Bob Newhouse. I guess he's a little bit embarrassed being in the backfield with Tony Dorsett if he didn't play well. And this year he has played extremely well. Look at the determination here, though, in the balance. A low center of gravity there. But mostly it's just determination, dogged determination.
He got away from Jeff Seaman, who tried to bring him down with his hands. That's just about impossible. So it is first and 10 from the Minnesota 15, 5:28 left to go in the ball game, and the Cowboys are driving for New Orleans. Newhouse running into Sutherland. So he stopped at the 15. Second and 7 for the Cowboys, and they have everything on their side now.
Well, when you speak of the Cowboys, you speak of the balance of the great organization. But offensively and defensively, special teams, they're just a well-balanced. You can't point to any one segment.
Time running down, 4:51 as they come out of the huddle. They're set to defend. And Tony inside, a block by Newhouse, but refusing to take the block was Nate Wright. A nice defensive play by Nate, number 43, shedding one block and making the tackle.
Dorsett has not looked good today. He just was not ready to play football for whatever reason. Maybe it was the injuries or whatever, but he's missed these holes. Sally hurt earlier in the ball game, limping off again.
Jay, with a bad right knee, recovered the fumble when Manfred Moore was knocked free of the ball by Tom Henderson. And Sauley comes out, and for Bud Grant, stoic, unflappable, you'd never know whether he's winning or losing. In this instance, he is losing. 16-6, 4 minutes and 2 seconds left to go on the ball game. And we will have a timeout, Dallas, with 3:59 left to go in the ball game.
Roger Staubach seems to let that happen to him one time in every ball game where he's got to stop the play, call timeout, and go to the sidelines. And I'm just curious what that is about. He's talking to Landry and who's that? Jim Myers, I guess. 31 years coaching experience in Jim Myers. You never get him mentioned. He's a member of the Zero Club, too.
For Roger Staubach, a 10th-round draft choice by Dallas, but a very good reason why. Dallas taking bows as well they should for great draft. They also gambled, because when Staubach graduated from the United States Naval Academy, he had to go away for 4 years. That meant they were drafting a guy who wouldn't put on the uniform for almost 5 years, but they figured he was worth waiting for. He has been well worth waiting for.
I would think. Look at the eyes of the hunter right there. You can just picture Bud Grant in a duck blind someplace. Look at those eyes. They dart. Scared me to death at the press conference the other day. What icy eyes he's got.
There's Goody, as they call him, Charles Goodrum, standing on the sideline for the Vikes. Staubach's numbers, 12 for 23 and 175 yards. Lee, 12 for 26, 155 yards.
Roger runs like a sissy, doesn't he?
What?
Just trots like a sissy. And we know he's not, of course, but he did.
Jeff Seaman comes out. Nate Allen comes in. Did you wear a helmet when you played? 3rd and 6 from the 11. Golden Richards in a slot inside Drew Pearson. Staubach again from the shotgun. Inside handoff to Dorsett. He's following Scott, and he goes in for a touchdown. Inside handoff to Tony Dorsett. And away go the Cowboys.
Dorsett can turn it on, though, can he? Beautiful blocking that time for the Dallas Cowboy offensive line. Herbert Scott out there in front of it, just the way you draw it up.
They had just taken Seaman out and put in Nate Allen, and so instead of the expected pass, the inside handoff, there's Scott and Rafferty.
Nobody to block. It's just drawn up that way.
Nate Chris. Wright came over and just took out the whole game's frustrations on him. So Tony Dorsett carries it over for the big one. It is 22-6. Efren Herrera, numero uno, makes it 23-6. And the Dallas Cowboys can be looking forward to Bourbon Street, the New Orleans Superdome, and they've got a date with the Denver Broncos. On the road to the Super Bowl, that's what it says, and that's certainly the feeling here in Irving, Texas now. The Cowboys capitalizing on a fumble by Manfred Moore on a vicious hit by Thomas Henderson, and they've cashed it in as Dorsett scrambled for the TD. Efren Herrera ready to kick off. Moore is deep. He is flanked by Sammy White and Robert Miller. Instead, it's a knuckleball down the left side, and it'll be picked up by Moore at the 12 to the 15. That's all. That time it was Mike Hegman, number 58, who nailed him at the 20. And the battle is almost over, and so the Dallas Cowboy and the Minnesota Vikings shake hands on the sideline. The battle, however, is still drawn down on the field. And that's Robert Miller, who is hurt. Miller, of course, the running back who had to play for Brent McClanahan, and Robert shaken up as he tried to go back and block for Manfred Moore.
He's played well, Ben, coming in. He saw very limited duty there until the injury to McClanahan, but he's played well in the last two games.
The timeouts left in the game, Minnesota with 3, Dallas 2. Miller apparently taking a pretty good lick to the head and appeared wobbly. We saw Bruce Heather go off with a similar blow earlier in the game. We have 3 minutes and 43 seconds left in the game. It is 23-6, Cowboys. And the Vikes put it in play, 1st and 10 on their own 20. And there is one of the big reasons why The Dallas defense has been so tough on the Vikings, who have had to settle for just two field goals. Ed Too Tall Jones. He's been too tall, too wide, and too fast. Too tough. First and 10 from the 20. Lee trying to hit, of all people, Mark Washington. You don't usually see a defensive back try to spear that one. He just couldn't quite get to it. The pass closer to Mark than to anybody else.
Yeah, I guess he did. Bob Lee, you don't empty his position when you got to try to play catch-up football. Not with that offensive team he's got against the great Dallas defense.
Bob Lee is 12 for 27 for 155 yards, but he has been unable to get a touchdown. Two field goals. That has been the story. Five backs in looking for the pass for Dallas. Second and 10 from the 20. Sammy White in a slot left inside Grimm, but it's a little release to Foreman, and he can't hold it. He was trying to bring it with him, and he left it behind. Mike Hegman there to retrieve the bobble.
I'll tell you who hates this type of ball game is offensive lineman. When the defense knows you're going to pass, they still got to just put up their chin straps and go ahead and know that they're going to get the strong pass rush. They hate it. What are you going to do?
Time left in the ball game, 3:33. And for Minnesota, when you look back at the numbers, the key for the Vikings today, the same key that has haunted them all year, that surprisingly stood up and allowed them to get in the playoffs. They had 18 turnovers during the year. They survived no turnovers in Los Angeles, and today it has killed them. Third and 10 from the 20. Mark Keller is in there now for Robert Miller. The pass to Foreman, and he takes it out of bounds with Mark Washington in pursuit at the 29-yard line. So Chuck Foreman handling the pass at the 29. We can take another look.
Bob Lee going, just taking, he's a pretty disciplined quarterback, Ben. He's taking what they give him. It wasn't enough for the first down that time, but who knows when you get the ball to Chuck Foreman. Chuck tries to, but there's just no room to work on that sideline. So he brings up a fourth down situation. They have no choice but to go for it. Behold the turtle. The only time he makes progress is when he sticks his neck out. Ah, you like that, Ben.
A poet you are. Fourth and one. And it'll be Chuck Foreman. And he has got himself the first down. The ball comes squirting out of there like a cork out of a champagne bottle, but it was after the whistle. So Foreman will pick up the first down. We have 3 minutes and 20 seconds remaining. You're looking at double sevens. It's Big Bill Gregory, and there is Chuck Foreman. Foreman so far today has caught five passes for 36 yards. He has carried the ball 21 times for 56 yards. Remember last week he carried the ball 31 times against the Rams, I think 33 the game before, the point being that they just hammer him day after game after game.
And he responds game after game.
First and 10 from the 32. Lee over the right side to Ahmad Rashad, and Benny Barnes there to bring him down.
Now Lee's going to have to go upfield with it. He hasn't got enough time do any damage with that little short stuff like that.
Picked up two, it'll make it second and eight. A reminder, the great show, 60 Minutes, will be seen in its entirety immediately following this game, except on the West Coast, where it will be seen at its usual time. Time remaining, 2:32. Out to the left side, and it is picked off by Thomas Henderson. He took it away from Sammy Johnson. And another turnover, although that is the first interception. Thomas Henderson, who hit Manfred Moore and caused the fumble that led to a touchdown, now comes up with the interception.
The big playmaker for the Dallas Cowboys, Tom Henderson, just an excellent athlete, as has been pointed out so many, many times. In passing situations, you can't get near that guy. He's got too much range.
And Bob Lee shaking his head, huh?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Henderson picked off one and went 79 yards against Tampa Bay earlier this year for a touchdown. So it's first and 10 on the 41 of Minnesota. 2:23 left in the game. Robert Newhouse. McNeil tried to tackle him and couldn't, and he picked up 10 more yards. And I'll tell you, Fred McNeil was a weary, weary player who tried to tackle him. And you're not going to bring Newhouse down when your arms are like lead.
Well, that ought to be an interesting matchup in the Super Bowl. Denver against the Cowboys, and rightfully so. Dallas Cowboys is a team that should represent the National Football Conference.
And the two-minute warning. And so the sands have just about run out for the Vikings. The Dallas Cowboys 23, the Minnesota Vikings 6. Well, a gallant Minnesota Viking team, not really outmatched by the Dallas Cowboys, but instead four damaging turnovers, and the Cowboys now are exactly 2 minutes away from New Orleans. First and 10 on that interception by Thomas Henderson. The Cowboys now trying to cash in yet another. And Robert Newhouse, Wally Hilgenberg, tried to bring him down from behind, but he just ran right by Wally. Interesting to compare Dorsett and Newhouse. Prior to that play, they had each rushed for 71 yards. So you talk about a well-rounded ground attack. Both running backs, equal number of yardage.
The appearance of Dorsett on the field makes the defense think a little different. Newhouse taking full advantage of that. He'd been waiting for a back to take the heat off him for some time.
From the 21-yard line, it is second and 5 Cowboys. You can see the time running down in the right-hand corner. Staubach to Newhouse. And again, he gets through weary tackle attempts. Studwell had his arms around him. He just slithered down. Robert Newhouse threw a shoe on that last turn with less than a minute to go. So the Vikings with a minus 18 in turnovers during the year. Turned it over four times. Dallas turned it over twice. And the Cowboys have been able to score. The Vikings only two field goals, and it is 23-6 Dallas. And it's Newhouse again. And once more, it looks like he's going to be hit behind the line of scrimmage. Studwell and Maloney converged on him, but he still picked up a yard or so. And of course, it's all over with 30 seconds left. And so to the Super Bowl on the 15th of January. And it will be hail to the Dallas Cowboys, hail to the Denver Broncos. And time will run out without another play. The Super Bowl right here on CBS from the Superdome, January the 15th. The Dallas Cowboys, who won a Super Bowl when they beat Miami 24-3. Will have the chance to win yet another. We are just a few seconds away, 23-6, Dallas. With 13 seconds left, Ralph Neely just came out, got bear hugs from his teammates. He will play yet another game in the Super Bowl as the Cowboys let the time run out. The Dallas Cowboys, Tom Landry and company, have done what just about everybody figured they would do. They beat the Vikings 23-6. And to a gallant Minnesota ball club, had they not done what they had done all year, they might have been a lot closer. But, of course, the four turnovers really killed them to such a strong machine as Dallas. We'll have locker room reports, so don't go away. Even though the final paragraph of the game story has been written, there are sidebars and notes to come. But let it be duly noted from Dallas, the Cowboys 23-6. There have been some great players in the game today. Let's meet one of them. Too Tall Jones will go to Gary Bender.
What a job you guys did today. Held them without a touchdown.
That's right. You know, just like last week when we played Chicago, we knew that we had to contain Walter Payton up front. Well, this week it was the same thing with Chuck Foreman. And our line played a hell of a game, I think, and as a result, winning the Super Bowl.
You know, they were running your side today, but you were hanging in there.
Well, they're a right-handed team, and, you know, Jethro and I discussed it all week long. We were hoping they'd run our side because, you know, I feel like with Jethro, I can gamble a lot, and he'll cover for me, and that's what was happening today.
You know, the Vikings are quite a team, though. They hung in there. It looked like they still had a couple of chances to come back.
Well, when do they do that? A lot of teams would have given up, you know, after the third quarter, but the Vikings been there before. They know what it takes to win it, and the people in Minnesota, I think, should really be proud of them because they hung in there and fought all the way.
Ed, did you notice Denver won? I'm sure you did.
Yes, and I'm really happy for Denver, and I think it'll be a totally different game from the game we played them here the last game of the regular season. They were playing without Craig Morton, and Craig, I think, is an excellent quarterback, and I expect a tough game.
You're in the Super Bowl in 75. You get to go back again.
That's right, and I love it.
Ed, you know, a game like this, the Vikings came in. Everybody said they shouldn't be here, that old veteran team, but you guys, you feared them.
Well, you know, I was afraid when they gave us an 11-point favorite. You know, I knew how it would affect those guys, and I figured they'd come in here really fired up. So what we tried to do was knock that fire out of them the first half.
We'll see you in New Orleans.
Thank you.
All right, now let's go to Brent Musburger.
All right, Gary, thank you very much. Jimmy the Greek, it is the Dallas Cowboys and the Denver Broncos. And who do you favor in the Super Bowl on January 15th?
Well, the last time the National Football Conference was favored was when Dallas was in a Super Bowl. And when they beat Miami. So we're going to make them favored one more time.
By about how much, Greek?
What's one of those kicks mean?
I think it's a field goal. I think that's 3 points.
That's right.
Irvin, it should be a whale of a ball game. Those two teams met in the last regularly scheduled game of the season, 14-6, I believe. Dallas finally won it. But the Craig Morton sidebar, so many stories to that Super Bowl.
You can take that last game of the year, Brent, and throw it out the window because of the Super Bowl game, as Jack Whitaker indicated in his pregame analysis, it's a second season. And when you go to a championship game like that, you have to play literally one play at a time.
There was a big controversy in the Oakland-Denver game today. Was it or wasn't it a fumble when Lytle was trying to go over? They ruled no fumble on the play, and Denver retained possession. But it is a wild controversy. John Madden has complained, and the league has issued this official statement that we got from UPI. The official, Ed Marion, who was the head linesman, said that progress had been stopped on that play. He blew the whistle, and then, according to Marion, the player lost possession as he was falling backward. But I think Jimmy and also Irv that that controversy is not over with this statement.
We saw the play, and the way we saw it, it looked as though that he'd been hit at the line of scrimmage and the ball had popped out. I couldn't tell who recovered the fumble. I assumed it was a fumble, but the only question I had in my mind is to who recovered it.
Let's face it, they blew it again.
Well, I don't think we should demean the tremendous job that the Denver Broncos have done all year because of the one call, however, in that game.
That has a Super Bowl game.
That's right. Absolutely.
And they deserve to win.
And we don't know what might have happened, even if they'd given the ball to Oakland. The NFL today will continue on CBS in just a moment. To tell us what it all means today, let's go down on the field to Jack Whitaker for his perspective. Jack?
Thank you, Brent. I'm not sure what it all means other than what everybody knows. That Dallas goes to the Super Bowl, and that's the way it should be because Dallas is the best club in the NFC. And in this year, when it's become embarrassingly clear that the NFC is below the AFC in quality, it is absolutely necessary that Dallas should have won their way to the Super Bowl. At the very least, the Cowboys will not embarrass the NFC. It also proves, I guess, that the track record, if you look up past performances, they pay off. Denver and Dallas are the winningest teams this year in their records, and they're going to meet in New Orleans. It should be a classic confrontation. Dallas going there for a fourth time, which ties the record held by Minnesota. Denver, of course, playing for the very first time. Experience against a very emotional team who is higher than the city in which they play. So Dallas against Denver, I think it should be a very interesting and refreshing Super Bowl in 2 weeks, and we'll see you all there. You too, Brent.
Thank you very much, Jack. I would have to agree. So, on the afternoon of January 15th, from the Superdome in New Orleans, it will be the Dallas Cowboys in the Super Bowl for the fourth time against the Denver Broncos. And why not? Those two teams overall have the best records in the league this year, won 14 times and lost only two. Right now, let's go down to the Dallas Cowboy locker room and Tim Ryan. Tim?
Thank you, Brent. Here with Coach Tom Landry. He must be a happy man today. This young team of yours performed so well, especially your defense and special teams.
Yes, we thought we had an excellent defensive game today. We were able to contain them most of the day, and then our specialty came through with Danny White running and a great hit there that set up the last touchdown for us. Offensively, we weren't quite as good today as we were last week, but overall, the team played very well.
How did you prepare for this game against Bob Lee as compared to preparing for a game against Fran Tarkenton?
Well, it's a lot different with Fran Tarkenton because you have to get the roles. You know, he's excellent at rolling, hitting his tight end, hitting Foreman, and just a little different. Lee's back in the pocket more. He throws more from the pocket.
Does it make it easier for you?
I don't know. I'm sure it makes it easier not when you're not playing Tarkenton. And I would want to take this opportunity to congratulate the Vikings. You know, they did a tremendous job after losing a great quarterback like Tarkenton and getting into the championship game. And you have to give them all the credit.
Now you've got Denver to face. I'm sure you weren't spending most of the afternoon watching that game. How much did you see?
I don't know whether we're far enough away from Denver and New Orleans or not, but I'm glad we're not playing them up in Denver because they sure have an enthusiastic people. And they had a great year, and they played super from what I saw. And I saw half the ball game today, and they were really all over everybody.
Should make an exciting Super Bowl. Thank you, Coach Tom Landry. Let's go back to Brent Musburger.
Tim, thank you so much. What a contrast. Tom Landry, the only coach in the history of the Dallas Cowboys. The Denver Broncos have been a struggling franchise. This is the first time that they've ever been in the NFL playoffs. And suddenly, they wind up going all the way to the Super Bowl under Red Miller. Many folks around the NFL said that Red Miller would never make a good head coach because he was too much one of the boys. And oh, how wrong Red Miller proved everyone this year. And on the afternoon of January 15th, it will be Denver and Dallas for the Super Bowl, Super Bowl 12, and CBS will have all the action. But that's just the beginning, because tomorrow afternoon, from the Cotton Bowl, the showdown for number one, the unbeaten Texas Longhorns against the once-beaten Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. They'll kick it off tomorrow at 2 p.m. Eastern Time. And so, for Vin Scully, Alex Hawkins, Jimmy the Greek, Irv Cross, Tim Ryan, Gary Bender, and everyone else who helped us make this quite a day for the NFC, I'm Brent Musburger wishing you all a very good evening.
The NFL Today is a presentation of CBS Sports. This is CBS.